is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good morning. Prime Minister Davis says political change is the greatest challenge in the climate change fight. Bahamas Air suspends into Haiti. And cost of living rise shocking, according to one major grocer. But he says holiday prices will be stable. It's all straight ahead this morning. I'm Dwight Strawn, and this is Morning Blend.
Wake up. It's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of a new way. Don't you know that day? It's the start of the end of the old way. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up.
Good morning again, Bahamas. It is Wednesday, November 13th, 2024. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Again, I'm Dwight Strawn. In a moment, Chester Robards will be joining us. Also this morning, we'll be talking with the Disaster Risk Management Authority and their Youth Ambassador Program. We'll get details about that and a whole lot more. That's all ahead. But first, for the overnight, the latest breaking news from while we're sleeping and the top national and international headlines this morning. In the overnight, the greatest challenge in the fight against climate change is political change, according to Prime Minister Philip Davis. Davis saying efforts to mitigate climate change should not be sporadic, done and undone after an election. While he did not reference America specifically, his speech coming a week after the victory of Donald Trump in the U.S. presidential election. Trump has cast doubt on the science backing man-made climate change. During his first term in office, Trump pulled the United States out of the 2015 Paris Agreement, a legally binding international climate change treaty, and has vowed to do so again. He's also promised to terminate much of the climate change policies put in place under U.S. President Joe Biden. Last week, Davis told reporters he wasn't concerned about the potential impact on climate change discussions and efforts in the wake of Trump's election, but in Azerbaijan, attending the 2024 United Nations Climate Change Conference, known as COP and COP29, Davis said recent weather patterns and phenomena, such as the hottest temperatures in recorded history, show that inaction on climate change would be the greatest moral failure of this era. He said, quote, "We're witnessing governments come to power that are retreating from climate commitments, dismissing the Paris Agreement, and turning inward. This isn't a crisis we can afford to address sporadically, nor is it a battle that can be won in isolated chapters, written with every election. If we leave climate action to the whims of political cycles, our planet's future becomes precarious. The climate crisis does not pause for elections or accommodate the sway of changing political tides. It demands continuity, commitment, and most of all, solidarity." Bahamas Air has stopped all flights into Haiti as a safety precaution after gangs shot two American commercial planes in Port-au-Prince on Monday. Deputy Prime Minister, Minister of Tourism, Aviation and Investments Chester Cooper telling reporters yesterday that the airline regularly makes assessments to determine whether it's safe to fly into the destabilized country. He said the safety of Bahamas Air and the passengers comes first and every day, every week. Pointing to the shocking cost of living rise, as reflected in the recent University of the Bahamas study, SuperValu owner Rupert Roberts says that his buyers have been mandated to carefully examine international markets in a bid to keep current prices, at the very least, stable. He said SuperValu lead buyers told the NASA Guardian yesterday that headed into the holiday season and the new year, prices expected to remain stable, but customers are being urged to give up their love affair with popular brands, which have consistently risen in cost every quarter due to manufacturers passing on the increases. A man charged with the murder of his nephew, prosecutors allege that Alfred McKinney fatally shot Christian McKinney following an argument at Phillinson Street on November 6th. The 50-year-old McKinney was not required to enter a plea when he made his initial court appearance before Chief Magistrate Roberto Reckley. He was denied bail and the matter was adjourned to April 16th of next year. A Supreme Court jury by majority 7-1 verdict acquitting Eric Arthur of rape after finding that the prosecution's case didn't fit. In a closing address to the jury, the prosecutor, Tamika Roberts, played the song "Who the Cat Fits" by Bob Marley, as she urged jurors to convict Arthur of the crime. Prosecutors alleged that Arthur sexually assaulted an 18-year-old woman on September 26, 2018, while she was home alone. Arthur testified in his defense at his trial before Justice Franklin Williams, KC. According to Arthur, he had a secret sexual relationship with the complainant, and they would hook up from time to time. He said that on the day in question, he went to the complainant's New Providence home. He says they were intimate, and after they were done, the young woman's grandmother returned home and asked why he was there. When asked, Arthur alleged the young woman made the false rape accusation, although they'd had sex twice before. You can read more on that case in today's Nassau Guardian. And the Ministry of Agriculture and Marine Resources is taking precautionary measures in light of claims that a rattlesnake was discovered on Harbor Island. A video allegedly depicting the snake circulated earlier this week. The ministry says officials have moved to confirm the contents of the video to ensure that they are real, but it says that in the meantime, as a precaution, officials have reached out to the Ministry of Health to source anti-venom and with the Department of Immigration to source work permits for expert snake catchers. The ministry is also investigating the alleged import through the Bahamas Agriculture Health and Food Safety Authority, as there are stringent processes in place to safeguard against these kinds of offenses. Overseas, U.S. President Joe Biden intends to bolster U.S. military support to Ukraine in the final months of his administration. That's according to U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken, who said today that after Russia launched a sophisticated missile and drone attack on Kyiv, the U.S. will continue to shore up everything they're doing to make sure Ukraine can effectively defend itself against Russian aggression. Blinken speaking with reporters at NATO headquarters before planned meetings with allied envoys and Ukrainian officials. Blinken warned that North Korea's decision to send troops into combat operations alongside Russian forces demands and will get a firm response, though he did not elaborate. And Israeli airstrikes killing at least 46 people in the Gaza Strip in the past day, including 11 at a makeshift cafeteria in an Israeli-declared humanitarian zone. In Lebanon, warplanes struck Beirut's southern suburbs and killed 33 people on Tuesday. The latest bombardment coming as the United States said it would not reduce its military support for Israel after a deadline passed for allowing more humanitarian aid into Gaza. The State Department cited some progress even as international aid groups said Israel had failed to meet the U.S. demands. In Lebanon, large explosions shook Beirut's southern suburbs, an area known as Dahiye, where Hezbollah has a significant presence. Soon after, the Israeli military issued evacuation warnings for 11 houses there. There was no immediate word on casualties. The Israeli military said it targeted Hezbollah infrastructure, including command centers and weapons production sites, without providing evidence. And dozens of soldiers and police fanned out across a neighborhood on a recent night in Turks and Caicos Islands just days after the archipelago reported a record 40 killings this year. They were on the hunt for criminals and illegal weapons, fueling a surge of violence across the Caribbean as authorities struggled to control a stream of firearms smuggled in from the U.S. Half an hour into the October 30th operation, one driver tried to run authorities off the road as he tossed a handgun into the bushes. But the flow is too strong, with illegal firearms blamed for an increase or record number of killings in a growing number of Caribbean islands this year, including Trinidad and Tobago and, yes, the Bahamas. No Caribbean nation manufactures firearms or ammunition or imports them on a large scale, but they account for half of the world's top 10 highest national murder rates, according to a statement from U.S. Senator Chris Murphy of Connecticut. In a letter sent to U.S. regulators in late September, New York's Attorney General and 13 other colleagues across the U.S. demanded new measures to stop the flow of guns, noting that 90% of weapons used in the Caribbean were bought in the U.S. and smuggled into the region. Attorney General Letitia James of New York writing, quote, American-made guns are flowing into Caribbean nations and communities and fueling violence, chaos, and senseless tragedies throughout the region. In mid-2023, the U.S. government appointed its first coordinator for Caribbean firearms prosecutions to help curb weapons smuggling from the U.S. to the region, with the U.S. Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco and Firearms and Explosives already tracing firearms seized in the Caribbean. Last year, 266 firearms seized in the Bahamas were submitted to ATF, along with 234 firearms from Jamaica, 162 from the Dominican Republic, and 143 from Trinidad and Tobago. The majority are handguns, followed by semi-automatic weapons. In sports, the junior girls softball playoffs for private schools underway at Freedom Farm Field, where the QC Lady Comets facing the Aquinas Aces in an exciting matchup. The Lady Comets emerging victorious with a 20-10 win, enhancing their impressive season record of 6-1. The Lady Comets taking an early lead, dominating the scoreboard with a 11-3 advantage. A strong start, an early finish under the mercy rule. However, the Aces capitalized on a series of errors by the Comets, launching a determined comeback that added intensity to the competition. But again, the Queens College Comets prevailing. The 12th annual City of Hope Bahamas Half Marathon, 10K, 5K, and relays set to kick off Sunday, November 17th at 5 a.m., hosted by Bahamas Roadmasters Running Club and established in 1990. The event will be part of We'll see part proceeds donated to the Jenny Dean Caring and Sharing Cancer Support Group. From 5 to 9 a.m., approximately 500 runners will take to the streets along West Bay Street. We've got the details of the route in today's Guardian Sports section. From the NBA, Eric Spoelstra blaming himself for a horrendous mistake after calling a timeout the Miami Heat didn't have with 1.1 seconds left in overtime Tuesday night, a technical foul that gave the Detroit Pistons the tie-breaking free throw. Malik Beasley made it, and the Pistons went on to beat the Heat 123-121 on the opening night of the NBA Cup play. Spoelstra saying, quote, "I made just a serious mental error there at the end." The Heat had a 121-119 lead after Tyler Hero's basket with 1.8 seconds remaining. But after the timeout, the Pistons ran a well-executed inbound play with Cade Cunningham throwing a lob pass that Jalen Duren slammed down. Spoelstra quickly and angrily stormed onto the court in motion for timeout, but of course he didn't have that. Meanwhile, the NBA Cup is back for a second season. Started last night, as we said, running through December 17th. It was called the in-season tournament last year when it debuted after years and years of Commissioner Adam Silver wanting to add something extra to the regular season. All 30 teams take part and will play four group stage games. From there, eight teams move to the quarterfinals, and the winners of those games will head to Las Vegas for the semifinals on December 14th. All games in the tournament, except for the championship game, count in the regular season standings and statistics. The championship game is considered extra and isn't part of the 82-game season for the two teams that make the final. But what's at stake? Well, pride, a trophy, and money. Players on the winning team will claim $514,971 each, while $205,988 goes to each player on the runner-up team. $102,994 to players whose teams lost in the semifinals, and $51,497 to those players whose teams lost in the quarterfinals. Who plays where and who plays when? Well, the breakdown is complicated, but we'll keep you posted on how things turn out over the next few weeks. That's sports, and that's the overnight. Time for your first look at weather.
It's a new day. It's the start of the start of a new way. Don't you know?
Your first look at weather for today. We've got a weak trough that's going to continue to drift across the central Bahamas with moderate to fresh breezes behind it. Winds and seas are expected to increase today, resulting in hazardous boating and beaching conditions. Meanwhile, a tropical disturbance just south of the area will increase shower chances across the southeast Bahamas while it moves westwards. So a near gale warning is now in effect, and boaters, especially small craft operators, are urged to seek safe harbor tonight. Well, today through tonight, port. And there remains an elevated risk of rip currents and rough surf, mainly along northern and eastern shorelines. Beachgoers are advised to avoid entering the waters. So for today, your forecast, partly sunny across most of the country, turning partly cloudy in the southeast Bahamas. We've got a 10 to 20% chance of showers in the northern, northwest, and central Bahamas, but a 20 to 40% chance in the southeastern islands. Temperatures today, we're looking at highs around 85 Fahrenheit, 29 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down about 74 Fahrenheit, 24 Celsius. We'll have your extended outlook and look at the tropics and what could be the next named system in our next weather check coming up in just a bit.
Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up today. It's the start of a new way.
You're listening to Morning Blend. When we come back, we're discussing the day's top stories right here on your home for fresh news and smart talk all day Guardian Radio 96.9.
Have uncontrollable debt? Are you ready to make that move to Fidelity for a stress-free future? These loans have a built-in savings plan that pays you unbeatable interest. Ask about our debt consolidation loans today. Call 356-7764.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
This message is proudly endorsed by the Minister of Economic Affairs, Senator the Honorable Michael B. Halkidis.
I'm proud to introduce the Made in the Bahamas certification, a mark of pride and quality. Join us on Thursday, November 14th at 5:30 p.m. for the BBSQ's National Town Hall meeting at the Holy Trinity Anglican Church Activity Center. This free two-hour event is your chance to learn more about the Made in the Bahamas certification program and how it benefits us all.
Transform your home for less at Kelly's House and Homes Holiday Paint Sale, Friday, November 1st through Tuesday, December 24th. Enjoy 25% off house and spray paints, plus 20% off paint supplies, excluding net items. Our wide selection of paint colors is the perfect way to bring holiday cheer to your home. You'll also find the best selection of brushes, rollers, and pans, glue, ladders, paint thinner, and more. So catch the holiday spirit at Kelly's House and Homes Holiday Paint Sale.
Thanksgiving has arrived early at Montague Motors. This whole month is Black November, with deep discounts on selected models. Roll out this season in style. Montague Motors, trusted quality service for over 20 years. Zero down everyone. Village Road near Shirley, 698-3950, 812-7576. Call Montague Motors now and get the best discounts the entire month of November.
What's that one gift you've longed for?
My own home.
Build or buy your home with financing from CIBC Caribbean, and we'll gift you up to $3,000 towards your legal fees, no loan application fee, and up to 95% financing. And if you switch your mortgage to us, take the gift of no switching costs up to $10,000. Plus, we're giving more with double the chance to win one of three cash prizes in your country. Visit CIBCFCIB.com/joyofgiving for more information. Terms and conditions apply.
Looking to elevate your gadget game, or a tech trouble simply slowing you down? Escape to a world of innovation at Custom Computers, your go-to store for the latest cutting-edge tech. Whether you need the best from Apple and Windows, or your device needs a little TLC, the Custom Computers Know-How Store is the destination for unbeatable expertise and quality repairs. With two convenient locations, there's a Custom Computers near you on Patton Street in Palmdale and Caves Village, or call 396-1100.
You try to rest. But roll with the best for all your printing needs. There ain't no one better, no. For posters and banners, magazines and flyers, for window decals, greeting cards and newsletters. No job too big and there's no job too small. You name it, we can print it. Just give us a call. Let Printmasters bring your masterpiece to life.
Located in the Nassau Guardian Building, telephone 302-2361.
What gift gives you joy?
An investment in land. That's joy to my future.
Finance your land with CIBC Caribbean and we'll gift you up to $500 fees, no loan application fee, and up to 15 years to repay. Plus, we'll also give you the chance to win one of three cash prizes in your country from our regional pot of over $100,000. Visit CIBCFCIB.com/joyofgiving for more information. Terms and conditions apply.
Wake up. Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of the start of a new way.
Don't you know that it's
the start of the end of the old way. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up.
Welcome back to Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. We are streaming live on GuardianTalkRadio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at MorningBlend969 or Facebook.com/MorningBlend969. Text us 422-4796. Standard text rates. Once again, I'm Dwight Strawn. In a moment, Chester Robards is going to be joining us. Also this morning, we're going to be talking about the DRM Disaster Risk Youth Ambassador Program. We'll find out details about that this morning. And there is a lot to talk about in business, everything from the cost of living and super value, their response to the rising, and more, including in today's business section, business owner saying that the mega resorts need to do more to encourage guests to leave the hotel properties. Is that how that works? Or do we have to offer more for them to want to see? Boy, we'll get into that in our business hour at 9 o'clock. But right now, let's get into what else is in the news. And in the NASA Guardian celebrating 180 years this month, and all month long, there's a lot of exciting things happening. There's the Vision Quest Challenge, Vision Challenge. You got to spot the logo, spot the 180th logo, and find it in the newspaper, get a copy of the paper, clip it out, write your name and number and everything on it, drop off that clipping in a special box at the NASA Guardian, the reception desk. And every Friday, 12:30, there's a drawing. If your name, if your clipping is drawn, you could win $180. It could be you. This is the third one this week. Only one more after this. So get your 180 logo clippings in quickly. And don't forget, we are doing Blasts from the Past every day this month in the NASA Guardian, just highlighting pages from the NASA Guardian over these 180 years. Today, we're looking back at 1945, coverage of the end of World War II, and big headlines. Japan surrenders, as the Guardian was right there for these big moments in the world, and of course, Bahamian history. And all month long, as we said, that's in today's NASA Guardian. You definitely want to save these. These are amazing. Amazing bits of history there. All right, so, Chester, we're waiting for Chester. Chester's going to join us in just a moment. The big headline, cost of living rise, shocking. We'll get to that in a little bit. But the other big story, political change is greatest challenge in climate fight. That's Prime Minister Philip Davis saying this. He's in Azerbaijan for the COP29 conference. But he was speaking yesterday and said the greatest challenge in the fight against climate change is political change. Davis said efforts to mitigate climate change should not be sporadic, done and undone after an election. While he did not reference America specifically, his speech did come a week after the victory of Donald Trump in the U.S. presidential election. Trump on the science backing man-made climate change. During his first term in office, Trump pulled the United States out of the 2015 Paris Agreement, a legally binding international climate change treaty, and has vowed to do so again. He has also promised to terminate much of the climate change policies put in place under U.S. President Joe Biden. Last week, Davis told reporters he's not concerned about the potential impact on climate change discussions and efforts in the wake of Trump's election. Davis is in Baku, Azerbaijan, attending the 2024 COP29 conference, the 29th. United Nations Climate Change Conference. Speaking at an event there yesterday, he said recent weather patterns and phenomena such as the hottest temperatures in recorded history show that inaction on climate change would be the greatest moral failure of this era. Davis said, quote, "The greatest challenge we face isn't just political will, it's political change. We're witnessing governments come to power that are retreating from climate commitments, dismissing the Paris Agreement, and turning inward. This isn't a crisis war to address sporadically, nor is it a battle that we won that can be won in isolated chapters, written and erased with every election. We leave climate action to the whims of political cycles, our planet's future becomes precarious. The climate crisis does not pause for elections or accommodate the sway of changing political tides. It demands continuity, commitment, and most of all, solidarity." Davis said the planet is at a crossroads and the price of inaction would fall on future generations and on communities that have contributed least to the problem yet suffer its harshest impacts. He said nations must resist the pull toward isolationism, stressing that this is the time for unity. He said, quote, "If we retreat into self-interest, if we abandon our shared responsibilities, we only weaken ourselves. Our climate fight demands unity, not division, and resilience, not retreat. Even if some of our friends turn away from this cause, even if political tides change and commitments falter, we must hold the line. Remember that the preservation of humanity cannot be left to chance, nor can it be treated as a gamble in the arena of political change. Let our actions today serve as a lasting promise that we will not turn our backs on each other or our planet, even when the path is difficult, even when the allies are few. Together, we can meet this moment and build a just, sustainable world for generations to come." During the first day of COP29, an agreement was reached on the trade of carbon credits. This would allow wealthy nations to pay poorer countries to offset their emissions by planting trees or protecting rainforests or other carbon sinks, for example. In July 2022, the Davis administration passed carbon trading legislation to establish the Bahamas as a leader in blue carbon credit in the blue carbon credit market. The Bahamas' vast seagrass meadows covering 100,000 square miles are considered one of the world's largest carbon sinks. Okay, powerful words, I think, from Prime Minister Davis. I think one of his most powerful speeches to date. Really well said, and I hope the countries, I hope they're listening. I hope they're listening. What say you, though? What do you think of it? Let's talk about it. 323-6232. 325-4316. 325-4259. Call us toll-free, 242-300-5720. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. Let's go to the phone lines. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Hey, Grand Rising, right?
Good morning, good morning.
Yes, right. I the same thing came into my mind. Who was listening? Right? Because it appears like our prime minister, he's speaking in the air.
Well, right? I wouldn't go that
That's
far.
That's what it appears, Dwight, because Donald Trump didn't tell you what his plans are when it comes to this carbon situation. This climate change, right? So there's nothing a little prime minister like you could do. You know, and you think they could be listening now? What you should have been doing, Mr. Prime Minister, was doing some things in the Bahamas when it relates to climate change, right? You know, we're using fossil fuel everywhere in this country, right? Why haven't we gone into renewables over the last 3 years?
We have.
Flying all around the country, the world. But there's no type of description of what you're talking about or what you're even attempting to do in your country.
No, that's a bit extreme. They have. It's slower than many would like. It's less than many would like, but they have. They've made great steps. Well,
for example,
tiny steps.
Dwight.
They have. Come on now. You know, solar. We've got Ragged Island. We've got more coming. They told us they're purchasing the land for the solar fields here. They're making the steps. They're looking at LNG now. They're doing some.
Right, Dwight? Mm-hmm. That ain't working, man, because we ain't seeing nothing. We're hearing all types of nice talks, you know, speeches, right? But when you come to the ground, right? Ain't nothing happening, Dwight. from
the, well, now
that,
see
that's
that the,
thing's supposed to happen in Ragged Island from Hubert.
That
Minister.
Is happening. It's happening. Huh? It's happening, but very few people live there. So.
Right, but mm-hmm. right. That's why we should. They need to make it happen where the people are, so that so many people can see what's happening. Right.
It takes a lot of money, but I mean, but the public needs to get on board as well, and that is the concern, right? That we aren't necessarily
on board.
The public
can get on board naturally once the government makes the move. Everybody
That's not fair. They've done a little bit.
They all pay light bill, you know, Dwight. You know that, right? Everybody paying light bill. So if the government makes a move, right, they can bring the people along. But you can't expect for the people to come before the government went the legislation in place for the people to go along,
no,
right?
No. You can do a whole lot more if you have the money. Unfortunately, it's
right,
expensive.
Right. So if we put legislation in place to help reduce the cost, right, then it can become more affordable for the people. You know, especially how we just realized that it's only rich and poor people in this country. You know, more middle class.
Okay. Well,
right?
The only way you'd be able to do that is if you manufacture it here, and I don't see that happening.
But you had one Chinese ambassador on your show years ago, which was telling our Bahamas government she could build Chinese could build panels in for the Bahamas for 25 cents, and all they had to do was put the legislation in place so that it could be delivered directly to the Bahamas. Ain't nobody hear that? And ain't Dwight, there, hey, it's the cop out. It's just what it is. Cop out.
Wow.
Right, have a nice day.
Okay, all right. Well, we've said it before that more needs to be done, absolutely. But to say that nothing has been done is a bit unfair. And my concern has always been that the public isn't on the same page as the talk that we hear from our leaders. Right? So more work has to be done in that regard so that we can only see us from the outside that the Bahamas is not joking about this, right? And unfortunately, you can't see. But they've taken little steps. You know this. They've talked about, although they haven't talked about it enough, the fact they've solarized some of the schools. There's solar panels on a lot of the schools. We tried to get them on a few months ago. The ridiculous excuses as to why they couldn't come yet. Anyway, that's a different story. But they've done that. They've done a little bit. So they've not done nothing. But more definitely needs to be seen to be done. And we all need to practice what we preach. You don't have to wait for the government for a lot of things. You don't. You really don't. So be careful when you point these fingers. You're going to poke maybe yourself in the eye if you don't watch it. Good morning, caller on the air. Hi, good morning. Are you there? Hi, good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning, sir.
Hi. Good morning.
Yes, thank you. The way you ended a while ago and mentioned that solar panels on schools, I've been taking a look. Very good.
I've been talking to people, but they are very afraid to talk on the radio before Clarence. Everybody is,
yeah,
I don't know what's going on these days.
I was impressed when I saw solar panels on Anatole Rogers School. So, yes, some things
that's quite
done.
A few.
Yes, right. Very good. The Prime Minister is on point, and the climate change situation is also augmented by, or made worse by all these wars and these bombs and all these black clouds of smoke all over the world. And, of course, America plans to cut a trillion plus in the new administration, and I suppose they don't have that trillion to contribute to reducing the effects of climate. So we'll have to watch and see how that goes. He's rightly, the Prime Minister is on point to say that we all need to, I mean, the other countries of the world need to still bind and stay together and hold it out and hope that good sense would prevail, if not now, in the future, that the changes wouldn't be from election cycle to election cycle.
Yeah.
Thinking locally, we should also, you know, a national development plan should also be a thing that shouldn't be pushed back and forth from one politician to another. And so, all in all, we are in the speech is in the right direction, and we can apply it locally and internationally.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Welcome.
Chester Robards joining us now. Good morning, sir. Great to have you with us.
Good morning.
Hi. What did you make of the Prime Minister's speech? Speech, I thought, again, some of the best say in a long time.
Well, I kind of focused on the finance part stuff. So.
Oh, you don't care about the environment. That's what you're saying?
That's a stretch.
Are you like some of the leaders he's addressing? All about the money, not about the planet. Yeah?
No.
Oh, I mean, okay.
We understand the planet stressors. Hmm. I think most people understand the planet stressors. But how does it help us as a country? Right? That's what I was focusing on. And what kind of climate reparations we're going to get in the future?
Well, likely not much with certain new administrations, right? And this is probably what folks here are concerned about. So the
conversation you had about in terms of renewable energy.
Mm-hmm.
I hear you say things are in movement, and the caller saying nothing much is happening. Can both things be true?
Right. It's baby steps. They're taking baby steps. I think a lot of people thought we'd be further along. It's already practically 2025. They made these pledges for 2030. This is really, that's very close.
It also seems like in some instances, people are being held back from implementing, in some instances, utility scale solar.
Mm-hmm.
And one has to wonder why that is. Because we continue to do these kind of big deals with partners who are still in the oil and gas industry, right? And they have to still make money from these new deals.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. So, I mean, does it profit some of them to get some of these big systems offline? What if all the hotels came offline? If all the big industrial places came offline.
Right. Yeah. Interesting questions. Let's hear from you folks. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259, toll free 242-300-5720. Tweet us, Facebook 6. What would it take to impress the Bahamian people? This text says, hey, the Prime Minister is a big flammer. That's it, and that's all. Wow. My goodness. This person says, hey, years ago it was global warming and the ozone layer, and now they changed to climate change and hurricanes. I don't know what you're saying. What is your problem? Okay, it's because it's more than global warming. They're having extreme weather, right? So extreme blizzards, extreme on the other end as well. So just so you don't say, oh, how come it's the coldest day ever in Tahiti or in Agua? Right? So you're going to say global warmings are real. So that's why they're saying climate change, too. So that people like you won't text in to say foolishness. But I guess that will continue to happen. This person says, it's simply a bunch of words put together, but an excellent communications major. Or by an excellent communications major. Oh, okay, I wonder who that is. No country's interested in going full throttle on climate change. What does that mean? What does that mean? What do you mean by that when you say that? You mean countering the effects of climate change? Uh-huh. They're all showboating, including the Bahamas. We are all simply hoping someone will prop up our flailing treasury with an injection of funds. We could care less, or we couldn't, I guess. Couldn't care less if they plant a tree, since we are cutting down entire environmentally protected areas in law to lay LNG pipes and place a beach chair for tourists, not to mention the continued obliteration of hills as we cry about increased flooding and sea rise. Okay, you're on to something now. We are not making any cohesive sense, and the world knows it. These diplomats aren't here for cocktail parties, although they do come. They have eyes, ears, and listening devices. They watch what we do. So there we go. That has been one of the big concerns, right? That we are saying those things, but at the same time, the trees and the hills and everything and the mangroves are being cemented up and chopped up, thrown away. And that's always
we're leaving
a challenge.
The hydrocarbons in the ground, though.
You sure?
as the PM say.
Oh, okay. But we do have to put some pressure on the other folks to not just because somebody new is around that you got to change your whole tune, right? Because that could be even more ruinous than what we're doing to ourselves. No? Okay.
What could be?
Sorry, you're breaking up.
I was just saying, what could be more ruinous?
I mean, if those other people decide, oh, yeah, we're not into this, forget it, and we're going back to what we used to do, and too bad. We got to bring down the cost of living for our people, and who cares what's happening to the rest of the world? We've seen this game before. Ironically, in this week of Remembrance Day and Veterans Day, right? When certain people were isolationist countries. Twice. And what happened? And how certain things have not been those that type of country. If they retreat to what they used to be, will we see number three? If you don't know what I mean, well, then you don't know what I mean. This person says, hey, you can have solar systems in your home or business, but your BPL bill is still extreme because of the fuel surcharge they hit you with. The Bahamian people just can't win. Dwight, did I miss something? How much air pollution is caused by the Prime Minister flying around the world to speak to the issues that impact us? On the most basic of levels, that's confusing. If I were somebody listening to the Prime Minister in any of his speeches that he's presenting on climate change around the world, I would call him out immediately for the lack of seriousness to which he speaks so adamantly about these meetings, because the actions here in the Bahamas do not align with what he's asking the rest of the world to consider. Well, you mentioned the flying around. Okay, I mean, well, he has to go to the conference, right? But you're talking about the other stuff that goes on in the Bahamas. I hear you. Okay. Dwight, that texter clearly doesn't understand the concept of global warming and the broader phenomenon of climate change. People too like to talk before they think. Yeah, well, that's clear. But here's another one. This fake climate change protest is a political pet project for the PM. This is certainly not a country that should be lecturing the world about climate change. As a country, the fuels and not solar, wind, or hydroelectric power. As a country who did not enhance public transportation to reduce the use of cars, and as a country who doesn't support the circular economy to reduce waste, we are simply climate change pretenders for the world. Wow. Okay. Oh, my goodness. Ooh. Okay. Boy, Jesus would have had a tough time here. I tell you, this was not, boy, you can't. Anyway, from month to month, my company and I collect garbage on the coastal shores of Nassau, and we still find plastics, garbage, and feminine hygiene. There we go. Feminine hygiene products that do not break down, so our Prime Minister can't lecture the world. Well, okay. Well, what more is there to say, Chester Robards? I guess that's that. Prime Minister, please stop wasting your time. Come here and fix these issues before you go out there and tell these people what to do. I guess that's the summary.
That is the summary.
Okay. Dear Lord. Well, there you have it. All right. Before we take a break, just want you to hear more about what's happening with Haiti and the chaos there. Another plane now has discovered a bullet hole, an American Airlines flight. This is after Spirit and JetBlue, and now all flights are canceled. And take a listen to what's happening with Bahamas Air in this report from our Vonnie Katoot.
Citing great concerns for passenger safety, Deputy Prime Minister Chester Cooper says Bahamas Air has suspended flights to Cap'haitien until further notice. The Federal Aviation Administration banned all U.S. airlines and commercial operators from conducting flights into Haiti for the next month after a Spirit Airlines and JetBlue flight were struck by gunfire at the airport in Port-au-Prince on Monday.
I must tell you of the great concern I would have for Bahamians traveling to Haiti, but all persons traveling in these distressing environments. We have a interest in that we are in close proximity to Haiti. And oftentimes we talk about catching the flu when the U.S. sneezes, but Haiti is one of our close neighbors. And we have a commitment due to our proximity and the close connections between our countries to be naturally very concerned.
The tourism and aviation minister stressed that the safety of the flight crew and passengers comes first.
And every day, every week, we make the assessment as to whether we continue service. From time to time, we have paused the service until the environment stabilizes. We generally fly into Cape Haitian, which is on the north and generally more secure than in Port-au-Prince. And therefore, we don't take the security of Bahamas Air and its passengers like. And it will always be our default to cancel a flight if we consider the ground to be unstable.
Last month, a six-member advance team from the Royal Bahamas Defense Force joined the multinational security support mission in Haiti, an effort spearheaded by CARICOM in partnership with international allies such as Kenya, Jamaica, and Belize. The aim of the coordinated mission is to provide critical support to help restore peace and stability in Haiti. Last year, the Bahamas pledged 150 officers for the effort. Earlier this year, gangs took control of Port-au-Prince, forcing the shutdown of the country's main airport and ultimately the resignation of then-Prime Minister Ariel Henry. Cooper says the Security Council of the Bahamas continues to work with CARICOM counterparts.
We have special envoys to Haiti, including former Prime Minister Christie, who works closely with former Prime Minister Golding of Jamaica. And we are in active dialogue with our armed forces, with our embassy on the ground in Haiti that provides intelligence support for the entire CARICOM region. So we play a key role in terms of gathering intelligence, in terms of being on the ground as perhaps one of the only embassies of the CARICOM in Haiti. And therefore, any issue that destabilizes Haiti is a concern for activity.
Reporting for the Guardian News Network, I'm Vonnie Toot.
All right. Hey, let's get your reaction to that. I think that's the best decision. It's terrifying what's going on. 323-6232. 325-4316. 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. This text, Dwight, I wonder about you sometimes. You want to be an MP or something, eh? Because you always giving these politicians the benefit of the doubt. Which Dwight are they talking about? Oh, okay. Certainly don't want to be an MP. No, definitely not. And they go on to say, the thing with Haiti about to heat up because the Haitian people don't want to bow to U.S. demands on who the leader should be. The U.S. is wicked bad, true demon nation. That's a text. That's the same person who said that I'm always giving the politicians the benefit of the doubt. So you have to take that message with as much doubt that people have about climate change. Yeah, let's take this call. Good morning, caller. You are on the air.
Good morning, Dwight.
Hi, good morning.
Dwight, I kind of feel two different ways about this thing.
Which one now? Which one are we talking
about?
With
the Haitian thing.
Okay.
Okay. Haiti has millions of people, and we are a small country, 21/7. We could see the destruction that is going on in Haiti. You might as well call the whole of Carmichael and Cowpen Road Haitian Island, okay? But now there is something brewing that is violent, okay? These people obviously had an issue with taking care of their own country. And our little 21/7, the government is saying we need to take on this violent, overpopulated problem.
Well, they're not really saying that. Are they saying that?
But it's being shown. Hmm? I called before and I spoke about the of Haitians that come through the airport. It's a racket. They have a system that is going on with how they pick up people, who transports them, who's waiting for them when they come, and immigration is there, and they know what's going on. It's almost like a ring. We see it every day. It's a ring. And so for me, I'm like, are these people just playing blind? Do they want to fix the problem? What are they doing? I don't understand what it is.
But I mean, these are, you're saying at the airport?
Whole of Cowpen Road.
Okay, so
the whole of Carmichael Road. Like, what are we doing?
Okay, but you're saying, hold on one second. People. You're saying you're seeing people come in through the airport. That's what you're saying?
Through the airport, so they're coming in the correct way.
So they're coming illegally.
You don't need to come. When last have you heard about a boat? When last have you heard about
a boat? So you're saying they're not leaving when they're supposed to leave?
My thing about it is back in the day, it used to be a situation where if somebody comes in who's not a Bahamian national, they come in as a foreigner. They say, I don't know why, there's not a system where they say who they're coming to. That person has to pick them up from the airport. They say that they're going back. And if they do not return to their country, or if they do not return to the airport to leave, then the person that they came to see, now the government now holds that person responsible for the individual that we gave them to when they came in. Because... how are we tracking them?
But you're making a lot of assumptions, though, I mean.
How are we tracking them? Why is it that we're not, if you're coming to visit, if you're coming on vacation, vacation is different from the hotel. Because if you're coming on vacation, you're staying to a hotel, you're staying to Airbnb. So, fine, we track you in that manner. But if you're coming to visit a family member, then we need to know where that family member is, where your area is, your address. We release you to that family member. That family member now picks you up. Write your name down and say, okay, this person is staying with this person for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, a month. If that person does not come back within the month, we have that family member's number. Where is he? Where is she? Where are they? And if they do not return to leave the country, then we hold that person responsible. We are outnumbered 5-1 with these people. I don't care what they say.
Mm-hmm. And you know for a fact that this is happening? The fact that what you're saying is happening or not happening, you know this for a fact?
This is happening. It's a ring by the airport. It happens every time a flight lands. So who are tracking these people? They have the cars. The van's already there. They pull up in the van. And then their destination sometimes is not here in Nassau. It's a destination. Sometimes it's in Abaco. It's like a rain that they have going on. Like, you could see it. We're not blind to it.
Okay.
Please, government, wake up. We're not stupid. We know what's going on, and you want to take on now this violent, overpopulated problem in 21/7. Y'all get it together, yeah?
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. Appreciate your call. Wow. All right. Let's hear what this caller has to say before we go to a break. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning, Dwight, cousin Dwight GN. And I can make it short and I can make it brief. Mm-hmm. But I call her on those who still ask the questions. Prior to the last general election, the prime minister got up on stage in Foxtel and he said, I am one of you and we're going to be together in a little while. Kote PLP. Thanks for taking my call.
Okay. You want to squeeze that one in? Hi, caller, you're on the air. Hi, good morning.
Is that me?
Turn on your radio, please. Turn on your radio.
Okay, fine. Dwight, she on it. And anybody that don't understand what she is saying, they don't want to understand. This is our country, and there's only a little over 400,000 of us. And we can't let people just come here, do what they want to do. And the thing is, it's illegal what they are doing. We got to stand up or get those niggas out of the house.
Okay. Now you're going too far, right? Boy. Chester, you're very quiet. I don't know why you're so quiet. Why are you leaving me out here in these shark-infested waters?
It's wild that people are shooting at airplanes in Haiti.
Hey, the craziest thing, though, I mean, she says that those parts of the island are basically another country, But they also don't, and they're working. They're all working. Everybody's working. The fish fry, all these other places that apparently weren't they owned by Bahamians? So what are we doing to ourselves if this is the case?
And they've recently been displaced in some instances, with shantytowns being torn down.
So what, unless you're saying that they are, that is who the merchant class is now in the Bahamas, the traditional ones, you know what I'm talking about. And now the Haitians and Bahamians are doing nothing, just working for people. That's all that the Bahamas is today. Yes, this is what we're saying.
There's a problem that Bahamians are concerned about, and they don't think that enough is being done. Like the lady says, she thinks there's even a racket in the airport that's allowing these people to overstay when they come. So, I mean, these are things that just need to be investigated. More needs to be done. We've known that for a long time in terms of immigration stuff. So this isn't new news. This is just Bahamians continuing a cry that's been going on for a long time.
Wow. This person says that caller is 100% correct. No lies. We have basically sold our country to Haiti. Bahamians are outnumbered at least 3-1. Wait till the uprising. Oh, my goodness. Okay. You can't. Yeah. Well, this text is saying, yeah, what's going on here? Because you can't go to the U.S. without showing a return ticket. No, you definitely can't buy one way anymore. So, and it should be relatively easy based on what she's saying, right? Yep. Where are you? You're supposed to return. You're not here. What's the deal? Wow. Caller, good morning. You're on the air.
How about Dwight?
Hi, good morning.
Hi, how you doing?
Doing well.
Okay, and Chess? The lady makes real great points. Me when these chat lines, we see these people coming because we have people down there in the chat line, and we see them coming. But Chester said something, Mr. Cooper said something that alarmed me very, very much. He says we are the only embassy down there open right now. And that got me confused. Why are we there and other people out? That's something to think about in the Bahamas.
I think he said CARICOM. Yeah, but okay. It's interesting. Thank you very much. Yeah, we'll take this and then we got to go. Good morning. You're on the air. Are you there? No. Okay, let's read these messages. Oh, yes. Hi, good morning.
Good morning, Dwight and Chester.
Hi, good morning.
How are you this morning?
Doing well.
Okay, listen, that system the lady speak about, but records to check, that system ever been in place, okay? Even if you're coming from Jamaica or the Caribbean, that system is in place. You have to give the immigration officer where you're going to stay, how long you're going to stay, and all that. But it's the same thing as Bahamians going to the U.S. and overstaying. But when people make an assumption that there's some crookedness going down at the airport, they have to be very careful of what they say unless they have to say it. The immigration officer only can do his job as far as what is the information that is given to him. Am I right or wrong, Dwight?
You would think.
You know, but at the end of the day, like I say, you know, everybody's blaming the Haitians, but they're not blaming themselves for allowing these people. They know the persons who are here illegally. They're not calling the authorities on these people because some of these people are their friends, okay? So when you speak with one tongue, make sure you use the same tongue to lash yourself at because you're doing just as the same thing that you're blaming others who come in here doing, okay? Thank you.
Okay, all right. Boy, all right, so let's read these messages as we go to the break. This person says, honestly, we need to clean up immigration and passport offices. Our Bahamian passport is being bought by many illegals. Were they buying it from Bahamians, though, right? So what are we doing? We need to hold our country over making a few dollars and selling our country. Good morning. Please don't read. Okay. I think I need to read this. I'm going to read it. sorry. The lady is right. It's a ring going on in the immigration department and the airport. They go to Abaco, and the destination is from there to the U.S. Trust me on that. That's the text. Okay. What are we doing? Our cabinet ministers have taught us that as long as I'm making money, it's okay, all from you, baby. And if I make enough, I might be assigned a diplomatic post as a reward for amassing so much illegal financial wealth. Whoa, these are a lot of claims everyone's making today. The earth will not know peace until we Africans unite. Okay. Shameful, the attitude we have to treat, not despise them. We say the stupidest things. I guess that person is blind to the Chinese here as well. What? And prove only our embassy is open down in Haiti. Again, I think he's at Caragon. All right. Wow. Okay. This texter here says, I don't know if I should read this. I just heard a story yesterday about a teacher who works in Abaco at a public school, and she was expressing how the school has employed more Haitians than Bahamians, and the student population is 95% Haitian. Notice when you go to supermarkets, the majority of the cashiers are now Haitian. Of Haitian descent, you mean, right? And, okay, perhaps. But then, I don't know what else to say. Okay. Hey, let's take a break. We'll be back. This is Morning Blend on a Wednesday morning on Guardian Radio 96.9. These are the hot issues that get people worked up. Climate change and immigration. What are we going to say next? Chester, to rile everybody up on this blessed Wednesday morning. Stay with us. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio. It was always you. And if I'm turning blue, nothing left to lose without my baby. Birds of a feather, we should stick together. I know I said it now. This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
It's a Christmas wish for all of you. Get an all-fee loan from RBC, it's true.
No more wishing for your Christmas ideas to come true. Get a no-fee loan from RBC and make those ideas a reality.
It's a Christmas wish for all of you. Get a no-fee loan from RBC, it's true.
Finding the right loan for all of your Christmas ideas starts with a conversation. Visit a branch to speak with an advisor today. Offer ends December 31st.
For the morning brought to you by RBC, the RBC Holiday Home and Auto Show, November 16th at the JFK location at Royal Star House. In your real-time traffic this morning, we're seeing heavy traffic on Milo Butler Highway, heading northbound. You're going to see that from well south of Ballant Road, straight through the Fire Trail roundabout all the way up to Tawny Gwilym's Darling Highway. Over on Gladstone Road, also busy for you from Fire Trail straight up to JFK Drive. Slow-moving traffic there. On Carmichael, a number of issues. You got slow-moving westbound traffic to Coral Harbor Road, west of Gladstone Road, and east of Fire Trail, you're going to see slow-moving eastbound traffic to Blue Hill Road, which is very busy this morning, from St. Vincent straight up to Independence Drive, especially north of Carmichael and north of the Soldier Road Junction up to the Independence Drive roundabout. Cowpen Road near Blue Hill Road and Zion Boulevard, that area looking congested for you, east and westbound, east to Blue Hill and west to Blue Hill on Zion. East Street also seeing some slow-moving traffic from just north of Bamboo Boulevard straight through to the intersection with Soldier and on the way to the roundabout with Simpson Road, with slow-moving westbound traffic from Soldier straight through to East-West Highway. Eastern Road, you're not moving from about San Suzy to Johnson Road if you're heading westbound this morning. And at the major intersections along Prince Charles Drive westbound as well. West Bay Street, seeing some slow-moving eastbound traffic to New Providence Highway and the roundabout at Saunders Beach there. So keep that in mind if you're in that area. That's what we're seeing right now in your real-time traffic. That's your Morning Blend Traffic Alert brought to you by RBC and the Holiday Home and Auto Expo this Saturday at the JFK location. Royal Star House. It is time for another check of your weather for today, brought to you by InvestFest Bahamas. We've got high pressure ridging building across the country that's going to support brisk winds and hazardous marine conditions across the islands today. Meanwhile, moisture from a tropical disturbance in the Caribbean Sea will produce some shower activity over portions of the southeastern and central islands today. So we've got a near gale warning and a gale watch in effect for today. Began this morning, boaters, especially small craft operators, are urged to remain in port. And beachgoers are advised to stay out of the water due to hazardous boating and beaching conditions. Your forecast for today for the northern Bahamas, including Grand Bahama, variably cloudy. For the northwest Bahamas, including New Providence, partly cloudy as well for the central islands, partly sunny in the southeast Bahamas, but 30% chance of rain in the southeastern islands. Temperatures today, we're looking at highs getting up to around 85 Fahrenheit, 70, that's about 28, 29 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down about 75 Celsius, 75 Fahrenheit, 24 Celsius. In your extended outlook for tomorrow, Thursday, partly cloudy, 20 to 40% chance of early morning isolated showers across the southeast Bahamas, decreasing to about 10. And that's pretty much the rain chances for the rest of the country as well. By Friday, partly sunny in the northern Bahamas, partly cloudy elsewhere. And Saturday, partly cloudy. We'll tell you more about the tropics and what could be the next name system in our next weather check after the 8 o'clock news. This weather check brought to you by InvestFest Bahamas, calling all entrepreneurs, business owners, and investors. Don't miss InvestFest Bahamas, your chance to take the next big financial step with access to BISC's licensed brokers. You can invest on the spot and participate in dynamic panels featuring industry leaders. It's November 14th, tomorrow from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. at the Convention Center, the Grand Hyatt at Bahamar. Purchase your tickets now at investfestbahamas.com. Network with top sponsors like RF Bank and Trust, Doctors Hospital, CFAL, Simplified Lending, and Leno Corporate Services. And don't miss out on this opportunity to access you need to grow. InvestFest Bahamas tomorrow.
It turns out that there is more than one special gift to give that special someone this Christmas. Consumers are searching for the perfect presents and the right prices. So why not place your products or services in the Nassau Guardians Holiday Gift Guide? And this year's Christmas shoppers will be sure to find that special something for everyone on the all-inclusive price. You can have your ads published twice in December in the Nassau Guardians Holiday Gift Guide, in addition to 10, 15, and 30-second commercials, and not to mention a web ad on the Nassau Guardians website. Advertising deadline, remember, is November 29th. For more information, contact your sales agents or call the Nassau Guardian Advertising Department at 302-2300. That's 302-2300. And ask about our Holiday Gift Guide Media Bundle. You don't want to miss this opportunity. Ring in those holiday profits by placing an ad in the Nassau Guardian Holiday Gift Guide.
It's easy to go the extra mile when you fill up with Esso Synergy Supreme Plus Fuel. It keeps your engine clean and running smoothly, which helps to make every fill-up last long. Synergy Supreme Plus Fuel today for better gas mileage and better performance. The Esso brand is a trademark of ExxonMobil Corporation and is used under license. Benefits are based on Synergy-branded gasoline compared to gasoline meeting minimum government detergency standards. Actual benefits may vary based on factors such as vehicle type, driving style, and gasoline previously used.
Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Street, has those hard-to-find fasteners for you right now. You can find stainless steel regular hex, carriage bolts, galvanized bolts, threaded rods, nails, self-tap screws, sex bolts, anchor bolts, turnbuckles, masonry tools, hand tools, and weed whacker strings. Check out the rope selection and car body fasteners, too. Special orders are welcome. It's your number one fastener store. Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Streets. Call 326-1976.
Make your house a home. Stop by the furniture store that's giving you more. With appliances, furniture, and repair, whatever you want, we got it all. From its furniture, no wonder so. We give it your life. We make it more.
Are you uninsured and seeking a plan that can give you quality health care at discounted rates? Unlock affordable health care with Doctors Hospitals LAMP. Enjoy unlimited primary care visits, exclusive discounts of up to 20%, and complimentary imaging and nutrition services. Visit doctorshosp.com/LAMP to register. Comprehensive, cost-effective wellness starts with LAMP.
Come on. We're taking this thing back to the islands, y'all. Come on. Bahama Islands. Come on. Woo. Yeah.
We're back here with Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strong along with Chester Robard, Spider-Man, here with us in studio now. We'll talk about that a little bit later.
Your name has a bad connotation in this country.
Does it? Since your shenanigans?
No.
Oh, okay. Let me read these messages before we go to
criminal shenanigans.
Oh, well, did you have permission to do what you did?
Wow.
Anyway, again, we'll talk about that a little bit later. But this back to the issue before the break, because, I mean, we were just letting you know all the chaos in Haiti, but now it's turned into something else. This texter says, hey, Dwight, this is an emotive issue. And yes, Carmichael is little Haiti. Oh, boy. I'm in Carmichael every weekend, and I see it with my own eyes. We have never had a sting in the Bahamas. All the alleged activities go unchecked when it comes to illegal migration. Well, I don't know. I don't know if that's true. I mean, the immigration buses and trucks are out often. I caught up in one, the holding of traffic, but they didn't look at me. I don't know. They were like,
who were you driving?
Certain cars. Right. But they didn't even, like, so what does that mean? So what does that mean based on what are they looking at? And that's how a lot of people will slip through the cracks. And that's scary because this is profiling and it's racial profiling.
It's true. Right.
And there are a whole lot of people who probably have extended their stay, overstayed their welcome.
And not just poor, disadvantaged people.
Right. Mm-hmm. Exactly. They're not supposed to be here. And you're not looking at them because of their color or the car they're in. That's weird. But anyway, this person says, they blame Bahamians. If we stop hiring, they will stop coming. When people are hurting, they look for a scapegoat to pick on. If the economy was great, no one would have any problems with Haitians. By the way, I tried on many occasions to hire Bahamian gardeners. They show up once and then never show up for 3 months. Right now, I'm pleading Bahamian gardener to come cut my high limb trees and still no show. The Haitian gardener is always hustling. He comes even at 3 p.m. and works through the dark to finish the general yard. Let us be real and honest. Wow. All right, the phone lines are lit up. This is going to go in
what's
a direction.
A high limb tree? Not,
high limb.
Oh, high limb. Oh.
Mm-hmm. Let's go to the news. We'll pick this up on the other side. The other things we want to talk about as well on this Wednesday, but we know this is one that works people up. Stay with us. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9.
I want you people to understand I am a proud Bahamian. If you're born there, you're born there. If you're born there, if you're born there, you're born there.
96.9 FM Commons.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We are streaming live on guardiantalkradio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your television 9 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can at Morning Blend 969 or facebook.com/Morning Blend 969. Text us on the Guardian Radio text line powered by BTC 422-4796. Standard text rate supply. And now at 8:23, time for another check of your weather for today, brought to you by Sherwin-Williams Paints. Here's what's happening. We've got high pressure building across the country. That's going to support brisk winds and hazardous marine conditions. Meanwhile, moisture from a tropical disturbance in the Caribbean Sea will produce some shower activity over portions of the southeast and central Bahamas. We've got a near gale warning and a gale watch in effect, and boaters, especially small craft operators, are urged to remain in port, and beachgoers should refrain from getting into the water due to hazardous boating and beaching conditions. For today, for the northern Bahamas, including Grand Bahama, look for variably cloudy conditions, a chance of spotty showers, and for the northwest Bahamas, partly cloudy, and a 10 to 20% chance of spotty showers. For the central islands, partly cloudy, with a chance for isolated showers. And the southeast Bahamas, partly sunny. Temperatures today, look for highs around 84 Fahrenheit, 28 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down to about 74 Fahrenheit, 24 Celsius. In your extended outlook for Thursday, partly cloudy, with a chance for early morning showers in the southeast Bahamas. Friday, partly sunny in the northern islands, with partly cloudy elsewhere. And by Saturday and Sunday, partly cloudy. In the tropics, we're watching an area in the central and western Caribbean Sea. Showers and thunderstorms continue to be associated with this broad area of low pressure. The system has a high chance now, an 80% chance of formation through the next 48 hours. And a 90% chance through the next 7 days. If this develops, which it's very likely that it will, it would be named Sarah. So we're going to keep an eye on that. That could become an issue for the Gulf and for even Florida by early next week. That is your Morning Blend weather check, brought to you by Sherwin-Williams Paints. Williams Paints got you covered for all your painting and equipment needs. Visit Sherwin-Williams Paints online or in store today. And time for another check of your traffic for this morning, brought to you by RBC and the Holiday Home and Auto Expo, November 16th at the JFK location, Royal Star House. In your real-time traffic, we're still seeing a lot of heavy traffic in your hotspot areas like Milo Butler Highway from Fire Trail straight up to Tawny Williams Darling Highway if you're heading northbound. And I'm on Carmichael Road eastbound to Blue Hill Road. Blue Hill Road is going to be busy for you from just north of St. Vincent all the way through, especially north of Carmichael. And Soldier Road on the way to Independence Drive. Independence Drive backed up in both directions, east and westbound. And slow-moving traffic on East Street, mainly northbound, especially on the way to Soldier Road and north of Soldier Road on the, as you head up to the intersection with East-West Highway and Independence Drive. Robinson Road also not moving much west of Soldier Road and Prince Charles Drive. From Beatrice Avenue, actually, westbound straight through to Robinson. Slow-moving traffic there. Prince Charles still busy near Elizabeth Estates and on the way to Fox Hill, the intersection, and then Eastern Road seeing slow-moving traffic from about Fox Hill to Johnson Road. Still busy for you near San Susie as well. Western New Providence, we've got some slow-moving traffic along West Bay Street. westbound, mainly near Sandyport for some reason. So keep that in mind. And near Saunders Beach, you've got slow moving traffic as you approach the roundabout with New Providence Highway if you're heading eastbound. Six Egg Roundabout also seeing some heavy traffic, especially on the Milo Butler side, northbound. Gladstone Road busy for you as well, northbound. And slow-moving traffic westbound on Carmichael Road to Coral Harbor Road. That's what we're looking at this morning. It's busy out there. Good luck to you. That's a real-time traffic in your morning blend traffic alert brought to you by RBC and the Holiday Home and Auto Show this Saturday at the JFK locations.
It's a Christmas wish for all of you. Get an Alfie loan from RBC. It's true.
No more wishing for your Christmas ideas to come true. Get a no-fee loan from RBC and make those ideas a reality.
It's a Christmas wish for all of you. Get a no-fee loan from RBC. It's true.
Finding the right loan for all of your Christmas ideas starts with a conversation. Visit a branch to speak with an advisor today. Offer ends December 31st.
Are you a Bahamian with property on one of our 16 island destinations? Well, the Tourism Development Corporation, in partnership with Bahamas Development Bank, is officially launching our Home Sweet Home Incentive. Join the vacation market by transforming your properties into vacation rentals. Earn up to $10,000 or more in funding and start building today. Register at tdcbahamas.com. from October 7th to November 18th. What are you waiting on? Build your vacation home today.
This October, Dunkin' Donuts is brewing more than just coffee. We're stronger together. Donate at any Dunkin' location to support breast cancer awareness, and we'll match every dollar you give. Together, we're making a real difference for the Sister Breast Cancer Support Group. Siv Smile Support. When we stand together, we're stronger together. Because the Bahamas runs on Dunkin'.
I been about Pinda and I meet him in his showroom. I say, Pinda, I just come out of a showroom in Portugal and let me tell you something, them showroom and selection ain't got nothing on yours. Man, I like this stock of porcelain, this ceramic tile you got here. What I really like is the range of sizes that come in, 8x48, 12x24, 24x24. And what I really, really like, more than the things I really like, is the price from $275 a square foot to $494 a square foot, and not even with a 2x4 from Enterprises.
Maybe it's time to explore your options. There's no harm in reviewing your mortgage arrangement and considering a better deal. CIBC Caribbean can help you narrow your search and decide. Switch your mortgage to CIBC Caribbean and enjoy a special interest rate and help towards your switching cost. Visit cibcfcib.com/inspired home for more information. Conditions apply.
Sherwin Williams Bahamas doesn't mess about when it comes to product range and product knowledge.
If it's a new product coming to store, we walk the store and study that product.
One thing with our boss, if a new product comes in, he takes the time and he's always keeping us up to date with product knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And we just had 9 weeks of different products that we had to study, and we had exams at the end of each product.
Yeah.
The only way we could sell the product effective, we have to know that product. Yeah, that helps us to relate to our customers. It gives us better knowledge to know what product to introduce to them. You understand? So we can know what product to give them to use and what product not to use.
Mm-hmm.
So product knowledge is really key in Sherwin Williams.
They got the keys. And the key is the product knowledge that comes with our extensive product range at Sherwin Williams Paints, Bahamas. Every day.
This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM.
I want them people to understand.
smoke. Proud to be a Bohemian. I born here, I born there.
Tell her that you born there.
I born here, I born there.
Tell her that you born there.
My grandpa meet my grandma dear.
Tell her that you born there.
My father meet my mama dear.
Tell her that you born there.
I born here, I born there.
Tell her that you born there.
I born here, I born there. The people are so friendly. Well, I'm there in Chucky. The people treat you nice and sweet. Dig it!
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9, Dwight Strano, Chester Robards on this Wednesday morning. Coming up in a few minutes, we're going to be talking with DRM, the Disaster Risk Management Authority, about their youth ambassador program. We're going to get details about that in just a few. So we're going to get back to the conversation we were having before the break. And callers, you can call in too, 323-6232, 325-4316. 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. We were talking about the horrible situation in Haiti, but it has changed now into how this is impacting the Bahamas, and so some serious claims have been made. But we have a problem. We know this. How much are we contributing to this problem as well? Because, like I keep saying to people, I've never, ever, 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 ever once had somebody of a Haitian, or beg me for money on the side of the road.
Mm-hmm.
Unlike what happens with some other people. But
part of the thing is we have to be careful how we talk about this issue as well. Everybody just want to spout off Haitian this and Haitian that and just very anti-Haitian. But we are an integrated society already. And to deny that is kind of to deny what the country is itself, right? There are Haitian Bahamians, and a lot of them, and their history and heritage should be respected as well. Right? Mm-hmm. While we have this conversation about, you know, closing the porous borders and you know, stemming the growth of illegal migration.
Yeah. This texter, All right, so this is a texter who texted early about we haven't had a real sting here. They're explaining a sting in terms of the people that work for the immigration.
Wasn't sting here last year?
This is not the time for jokes, sir. Not the time for jokes. In terms of the people that work for immigration and the passport department. Ooh, boy. Okay.
And the passport
operation. They want a major operation. People want to hire Haitians because we can get a Mason for $100 a day, Haitian Mason for $100 a day, and a Haitian helper for $40 a day, while a Bahamian Mason won't take less than $175 per day, and a helper would work for $75 a day. It's all about money.
But we have, when we have Leonard Sands on talking about those things, he says the opposite. He says they work for what the averages for the sector. That must be like somebody private you're picking up on the side of the road.
Maybe. You know, right.
Not somebody who's working for a company.
No. Yeah. If you want it for your business, for your home or something like that.
Yeah.
Sure. This person says, blame Bahamians. If we stop hiring, they will stop coming. When people are hurting, they look for escape. I think we read the part already, right? Yeah. Okay. Yes. This person says, please give that person my number who needs a gardener. Okay.
That's true.
Please hire more productive police officers for the traffic division. Please, crying out as a citizen living here in chaos. It's chaos this morning. Out there looks pretty bad this morning. Let's take this call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning. How you doing, sir?
Doing well.
Good morning, Chester.
Good morning.
Mr. Stone, what I want, I mean, to be on, I get tired of dying, Mr. Stone. I mean, especially considering, you know, we are black people, all us black, right? But I want to ask a question. Can you be illegal on stolen property?
Can you what?
Can you be illegal on stolen land?
Illegal on stolen
land? I understand. You mean an undocumented person living on land that's not yours? Is that what you mean?
The point I'm trying to get at, Mr. Stone, is that I'm trying to figure out, like, where in history, you could always tell, I mean, you could tell the mental level, intelligence level of a people by the thing they see as the common problem among them. Like, what they choose to argue about, like, you know what I mean, the things they choose to discuss as the problem. You know what I mean? All these things going on in this country, all these different things going on, which are very serious, and the only thing we could talk about for decades over and over again is the Haitian people. You understand where I come from? That's that de average. You know what I mean? And see, the thing about the de average, Mr. Stone, is that my parents were not, at least my father was not as educated as my mother. They had to leave school kind of early. So you see, so we was always dumb as a society. We just trying to get smart now. We still de average. See, this is the point I'm trying to make you do, Mr. Stone. We stand on land where we, this was taken from other people. You know what I mean? We don't want to face history. We only want to talk about our life and our existence after majority rule. We don't want to talk about the things before that. You know what I mean? Because if we engage in conversations that over a period, we wouldn't be talking about the Haitian. You understand? Because, see, if you were to go to Arawak Indian right now, I mean, if you could find one, he would say the white man is the illegal person over here. You know, the white man is the only illegal immigrant on this part of the world, you see? We need to ask ourselves, where in history do we start to say history truly begin? Like, whose side of the story are we telling? Whose side of the story are we living? Because if we were to live the truth, the white man is the only illegal immigrant on this part of the world. He's the one who caused the situation right now that we're in right now, this mix-up, by bringing us over here and separating us, and now we can't get together and be arguing amongst ourselves. We need to stop this stupid Haitian behemoth thing. Okay. These are all black people from Africa, man. You know,
so, I mean, this is not helpful to the conversation, but what would you propose that people do with that?
I propose that we look at history, right? Go back as far as we can, right? And try to tell it from our part, from our perspective. You know, that kind of way, and try to respect, right? And try to look at it from a God perspective. You know, that kind of way, try to look at things with God's eyes. You know what I mean? If God was to come here right now, you'd say, you know something? All, you know what I mean? And if everyone, like how white people, and white people would be the first one to say, everybody needs to go back where they come from. Well, if everybody go back where we come from, the white people will be back in Europe, the black people will be back in Africa, and the Indian, the Cuban people, however you want to call them, the Native American style people, they'll be over here. You know what I mean? Let's stop arguing over this stupid Haitian and Bahamian thing, because like I said before, we need to live together for one. We need to respect the Haitian people and for what they have done in terms of how they defeat the French, and we need to respect the fact that why Haiti is the way it is today. You know, that kind of way, and stop trying to blame the Haitian people for their own country when it's the interference of foreign countries, especially America, inside their business that caused them to be the way they are now. They will not allow Haiti to operate as a nation should. We, you know what I mean? We need to face that fact, all right? Now, like I said before, Mr. Strong, we need to start to face reality, man, and start to raise the conversation and stop talking about this Haitian thing. I'm getting tired of sick and tired of hearing African people arguing among themselves. We need to unify, man, you know what I mean? And I don't want to get a stupid behemoth calling you talking about nothing stupid about behemoth, all right? Because we are all African people. Y'all have a good day, man.
Okay. But good morning, caller. You are on the air.
Hi, good morning. How are you?
Hey, right here.
That's nice. I'm calling in regards to that snake. My thing is, I worked in the shipping industry for about several years, and if that snake hike a ride, it's very rare that it hike a ride on that vessel. The thing about it is that when that vessel arrives into the port, a forklift has to go on board that vessel, lift that container off, put that on the ground. The broker now who is clearing these items has to be there along with the customs officer to break that seal to make sure the commodities and what's on that bill of lading. That container now has to be exported to the relevant person by a trucker. If that container is going on the mail boat, that has to go on the mail boat, okay? And when that arrives in the family island, the person has to transfer that to the customer, okay? So I say that to say this. With all that export, don't you think that that snake would have came off on that cargo ship or that mail boat? Or even the truck, okay? And I look at it like this. That snake perhaps was somebody's pet. And I know we
all right,
have...
Well, let the, this is... before you go on. So we're not certain whether this is real.
Yes.
So they're doing investigations, right? Right.
Right.
The video that was seen is... interesting is the best word I can say. So until we know for sure, there's a lot of speculating going on here. But they're just asking everyone to be very careful. But it's not outside the realm of possibility that strange things can get into the country. Not at all, right? And people are bringing in all manner of things. We've had it before. We've had those weird little silly-looking albino lizards. Not here before the mid-90s. And so, yeah. So everyone be on the alert until it is verified whether that video is accurate. I don't know if anybody can say they saw the snake with their own eyes. But there's somebody who had a video, and every video that's seen, somebody thinks it's from the Bahamas. It could be a pyramid in the background. They say, that's right there in Baintown. Like, okay.
I've gotten word that he took a ferry to the mainland.
That he what?
Huh?
He. Well, again, we hope it's a he. We hope it's a he. Because, yeah, how much did he pay for that? Anyway.
I think it's $2 for
snakes. This text is just waking up from a coma. They're saying, after JetBlue and Spirit Airlines experienced attacks on their aircraft flying into Haiti, don't you think Bahamas Air should suspend flights going to Haiti? Texter, I don't know where you've been. Welcome. Good morning. I'm glad you're up now. I mean, seriously? What's happening?
You're sure that text wasn't like far down and you just...
No, they said that at 8 o'clock. We already played the report. We ready.
Maybe it just went through.
You think they said it, what, 2 days ago?
Maybe.
Okay. Well, we cannot build a progressive society where our immigrant population is one quarter our size, growing every year and below the poverty level. No country can sustain this. Cayman has a large immigrant population, but they are technically skilled workers. My parents had to leave school at an early age, but they were far from dumb. Nobody could spell better than my mother, and no one could tinker with tools like my daddy.
Is that the same caller? Caller's text.
I think they're responding to the person who called everybody dumb. The guy talking about all of us are African said a lot with absolutely no conclusion as to what should be done. Now, every nation has borders now and do what they can to protect their borders. What should be done now, though? What's he saying? Just, I guess, let everybody in.
I mean, I understand where he's coming from.
You do?
Yeah. I mean, I get it, right? I get it. Don't whitewash history, you know. Respect the fact that this country has been struggling for forever.
Yep.
Look at it through more compassionate eyes.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but exactly. But there is there is no and what, because you would have to unravel an entire system of governance in so many places to try and put society back together the way he think it should be put together. So. But you understand, you know.
No.
I understand what he's saying. I understand what he's saying.
I can't. I don't understand.
Yeah,
hence
understand.
The very long pause.
I understand the cry.
Afterward.
I understand the cry.
Yes, we feel, many of us, not all clearly, but many of us feel great pain for Haiti. It's horrible what's happening. And yes, many of the countries who are making noise today contributed to the problems.
Yes.
But yes, what do you do now? Right. What do we do now?
Right. Exactly.
We have a problem.
I mean, it's like the people in England who were like, you know, y'all go wait for reparations because they ain't coming from here, right? Mm-hmm. And those are the people who caused a lot of our problems.
You know? Yeah, absolutely.
So,
absolutely.
You know, that's what causes people to feel the way he feels.
Mm-hmm. Take quickly, we got to move on. We got guests. Good morning, you're on the air. Hi, good morning. Hi, are you there? Hi, yes. Okay. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning. So in America, right, they talk about, when it comes to the electorate, they talk about the single-issue voter and the single-issue-driven voter and the potency of such a person and how it can sway, impact, possibly even sway an election. And so last cycle, general election in this country, we had a party that made immigration the centerpiece of their platform. and they didn't fare well. So I'm thinking that maybe behemoth, as much as there's a hue and cry, is not elevated to the point of single-issue driven voter. And so I guess until we elevate it in across the class of behemoth, that's enough to put stuff to sway or impact an election, I guess we're just talking. So just make it a single-issue driven. Just be single-issue about it. There's parties that speak to it that are going to come around again and use your vote. That's what I say. And until then, that's just bide your time. That's what I say. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you very much. I mean, I perhaps Bahamian, people didn't like what those people were saying.
I think Bahamian,
maybe that's it.
The single issue for Bahamian voters is how do I feel about my life at this point in time?
Money.
Yep.
Money. That's
is my life better?
That's always been.
Is my life better than when they came in? And if the answer is no, they might vote you out.
I think these islands have been about money from from as far back as 1492. And I don't know if it's ever going to change. This person says here, I think the accusations made by the caller concerning the airport needs to be investigated. If it's true, if you missed it, we had a caller who, this is what started this conversation about folks coming in and never leaving. The same texter says, here we go. I literally had to run out of a store on Carmichael because everyone was speaking Creole. Okay.
Run out of it because store.
You were going to catch it. I don't understand what your problem. Okay. Anyway. And it's, I can't even read the rest of this. It's getting worse.
Really?
Yeah. Much worse. This is awful.
You mean something happened after they ran out of the store?
No, I mean the other comments they're making. Look at that. I don't read it.
What the heck?
Why would you text that? Why? And then they say, I'm deeply offended that you allowed that caller to call Bahamians dumb and stupid multiple times.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, boy.
Okay.
Lord. Sometimes the text. Anyway, he also said Bahamians were very dumb and always dumb. Every country talks about immigration to secure its borders. Why didn't you cut that caller off? You usually cut people off when they insult Haitians, but you allow him to demean and Bahamians on national radio. That's not demonstrating national pride.
He had to cut off some of your text messages.
And you throw this phone away. Boy. Let's go to a break. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. We'll be back.
Technology is not a choice, it's a necessity. And for businesses that demand excellence, there's only one choice for unparalleled support and cutting-edge technology. Custom Computers. You have challenges and we have solutions. Computing, networking for enterprises large and small, aligned with premium brands like HP, Microsoft, Konica Minolta, and more. Get tech done the right way with Custom Computers. Call the know-how team at 396-1101.
We were set to battle, and your Aunt Angie was leading the pack when...
Aunt Angie, what does this have to do with car damage?
Oh, right. Well, long story long. I took down the assassins and wound up inventing a new form of mixed martial arts. I became an international champion until one sore loser karate kicked my car. But I was covered with CG.
Cover for malicious damage and more. CG Atlantic Insurance, agents, and brokers. Good like that. All benefits are subject to policy provisions, including eligibility and time of service.
It's easy to go the extra mile when you fill up with Esso Synergy Supreme Plus Fuel. It keeps your engine clean and running smoothly, which helps to make every fill-up last longer. Choose Esso Synergy Supreme for better gas mileage and better performance. The Esso brand is a trademark of ExxonMobil Corporation and is used under license. Benefits are based on Synergy-branded gasoline compared to gasoline meeting minimum government detergency standards. Actual benefits may vary based on factors such as vehicle type, driving style, and gasoline previously used.
Here's a price list of some of the roofing material we carry at Pinda Enterprises. 5/8 pressure-treated roofing ply, starting at $36.68. Gray Select Water Shield, 134/20 a roll. Felt, 15 pounds, 16.50, 30 pounds, 19.80. Owens, Corning Duration Shingles, and CertainTeed Landmark Shingles, $56.56 a bundle. Gallon of roof cement, $33.47. All sizes treated dimensional lumber. And of course, we have all nails and all screws. We have 5/8 sheetrock, $28.76. Half-inch sheetrock, $22.18. All prices include VAT.
The joy of giving comes with rewarding you with cash prizes from our regional pot of over US $100,000. Simply apply for a personal loan, auto loan, land loan, or mortgage from CIBC Caribbean. Once approved, you may be entered for a chance to be one of three lucky winners in your country. Each winner will pull a card with a surprise cash prize of US $1,500, US $2,500, or US $5,000. Visit CIBCFCIB.com/joyofgiving. CIBC Caribbean terms and conditions apply.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Cleveland Clinic is recognized as a leader in healthcare. Our team of experts relentlessly pursues the best for our patients. From groundbreaking cancer research to state-of-the-art heart surgery, life-saving innovations happen here every day. When it's time to travel for your health, it's time to travel to Cleveland Clinic. Your destination for care, for every care in the world. To learn more, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
This holiday season, give the gift that lasts a lifetime. Financial freedom with CFAL. Whether you're looking to take the stress out of holiday giving or plan for the future, CFAL has you covered. With our suite of savings products, you can start with a minimal upfront investment and low monthly contributions. Get a jump start with 2025 financial goals with CFAL Savings Express, or give the little ones a head start with the CFAL Education Plan. You can also secure your own future with the CFAL Blue Marlin Retirement Plan. This holiday season, make your gift count with CFAL, where small savings lead to brighter futures. Visit CFAL.com today to start building wealth so you can live well. Happy holidays from all of us at CFAL.
Busy mornings demand a hearty breakfast, so start your mornings off the best way with Wendy's new breakfast wrap, packed with fresh cracked eggs, breakfast potatoes, and a melty cheese sauce, with a choice of savory sausage or crispy bacon, all wrapped in a warm, soft tortilla. Wendy's always serves breakfast the right way.
Thanksgiving has arrived early at Montague Motors. This whole month is Black November, with deep discounts on selected models. Roll out this season in style. Montague Motors, trusted quality service for over 20 years. Zero down everyone. Village Road near Shirley, 698-3950, 812-7576. Call Montague Motors now and get the best discounts the entire month of November.
Are you looking to save for a big purchase or occasion? Do you want your money to start making money for you? Well, let me introduce myself. My name is Bond, the Bahamas Government Savings Bond. I am guaranteed to earn interest on your money with terms ranging from 1 to 6 years. Government Savings Bonds are available to offer as little as $100. You can start to save for your future. The Bahamas Government Savings Bond, a safe investment guaranteed. Check out the Central Bank of the Bahamas website for details.
Another party, another year, everybody! Here we go, it's November!
in me. I just need to be free. I'm ready to party. The fire in my soul, I'm ready to let go. Get ready to party. It's in my head,
oh yeah.
It's in my feet,
uh-huh.
It's in my soul,
all right.
All over me.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strawn, along with Chester Robards, and we're going to go to news in just a bit, but let's launch, let's talk about what we're going to be talking about, the Disaster Risk Management Authority Youth Ambassador Program. And here to tell us all about this, we're very pleased to welcome back. This show's been a while. Assistant Director of Strategic Communications, Shantez Dillard Wilson, and we have Communications Officer Jordan Clark with us as well. Good morning. Great to have you all with us.
Good morning, Dwight and Chester.
Good
it's
morning.
So fantastic to be back.
It's been a while. It's been a while.
This new position.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful to have you. Welcome. Welcome.
Good morning and thank you.
All right. So let's talk about it. For folks who I don't think very many people don't know about the DRM, but tell people what the DRM is before we get into the Youth Ambassador Program.
Absolutely. So the Disaster Risk Management Authority is the nation's leading and central agency for disaster management in the country. So for most people, that means hurricane response. But we are a merger between NEMA and the DRA. So combining what they did once upon a time to create a comprehensive disaster management authority. So rather than just dealing with response and preparation, we deal with the full cycle of disaster. So we're talking mitigation, which is the biggest thing that we've added in, more long-term planning and disaster risk reduction strategy in order to have us prepared way before a storm is even threatening our shores, making sure that we're putting in place a lot of institutions to ensure that we're not just ready, but we are minimizing the impact that storms have when they do hit. And then, of course, the rest of the cycle, which most of us are more familiar with, our preparation, our response, and our recovery. Mm-hmm. Now, one of the things that's a little bit different is where DRA used to do more long-term recovery. The DRM authority is only short-term recovery, and then we hand over to the responsible institutions. But full cycle, comprehensive disaster risk management. And of course, a few other things in our approach, being a lot more integrating external stakeholders. You know, NEMA has always worked with external mm-hmm. stakeholders. We're building on a pretty robust foundation that they've put in place for us. But, you know, we are going to be institutionalizing that a lot more with things like an NGO council and a lot more in-place protocols for how we deal with international partners, for example. Mm-hmm. And we're also going to be putting in place a lot of protocols for public bodies and sectors so that we are including all of the community, because response to disaster is not just a government thing. I mean, we lead the charge 100%. We coordinate that. But as we saw in past storms like Dorian, other parts of the community are a huge part of that,
right.
A huge part of that.
Yeah.
And so youth are too, which
absolutely.
Is why we
yeah,
have... really wanted to, in our first year, we straight out the gates, we just started in July. July, wow, mm-hmm. time flies. So we only a few months in, but we wanted straight out the gate to make sure that we were including youth, because if we're talking mitigation, if we're talking securing our future, we need to be talking about getting the next generation on board with how we're doing that right away.
Right.
So we have launched the Disaster Risk Reduction Youth Ambassadorship. This is its inaugural iteration, and it is a compass. We wanted to go a little younger than the usual youth ambassadorship so that we're getting them early. We're getting them at a point where they're first learning about these systems, but also old enough that they can handle shoulder the responsibilities of an ambassadorship.
Mm-hmm.
So we're inviting 10th graders from all across the country. We want to make sure that we're getting submissions from the Family Islands as well. So we're inviting all 10th graders, if you know any 10th graders that are really passionate about this country's future and, climate change and its impact on our weather systems and our natural hazards, please have them apply. The application can go to our email address, connect@drm.gov.bs, or at drm.gov.bs/speech-. comp.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's a competition, speech competition.
Mm-hmm.
Videos as well, right?
So it's a video speech competition.
Video speech, okay.
So we want you to submit a 3 to 5 minute video speech on our theme, empowering the next generation for a resilient future. So we invite you to talk about what that means for you. Mm-hmm. What do you be empowered to speak about about climate change and weather systems and the disaster risk management that we have in place and the future that you see for our country in responding to, preparing for, mitigating against hazards like hurricanes.
Yeah.
And some of the other hazards that we are seeing more frequently. Storm surge has become a thing during hurricanes, flooding, and more wildfires.
Yeah.
So don't limit yourself to hurricane. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right. So how many ambassadors are you looking for?
Two. So we'll be selecting one male and one female ambassador.
Mm-hmm. And the deadline is fast approaching.
It is November 30th. So I want to say that our original deadline was November 17th. We have extended it. Mm-hmm. We've seen a good bit of interest, over 70 expressions of interest, but what we were seeing is that it was a little bit Nassau-centric. Mm. We want to make sure that we're reaching out to the Family Islands and getting submissions there. So we've extended it, calling all Family Island 10th graders, please send in your submissions. And those of you who have expressed interest and have not finished up your applications yet, time's a ticking.
Yeah.
Get those in.
All right. So
how have you gotten the message out to the Family Islands?
Thus far, so we have been working with the Ministry of Youth and Ministry of Education, so in a more direct way, but we will be pushing a lot more into those spaces in the coming 2 weeks.
Mm. All right, so we're going to go to news in a bit, but just want to get this out there for anybody who's still in the car, who has kids with them, who can let them hear this. But what will the youth ambassador be required to do? And will this just be for the year that you're in 10th grade?
So, yeah, it's a one-year program, mm-hmm. and, well, actually, I'm going to throw this to Jordan, and he can talk a little bit about what it means to be an ambassador, because you may not know this. Jordan, our communications officer, is also a youth ambassador with the Ministry of Youth.
Okay.
So he can talk about what it means to be an ambassador in general and how we actually reflected some of his experience in what we put in for.
Excellent. Jordan Clark, tell us about that.
Yes, so I am the Bahamas' youth ambassador to the Commonwealth. And so what it means to be an ambassador is to be a voice and to be someone to advocate for what is needed, what you believe in, and what you respect. So for me as an ambassador, it is climate action, disaster management, as well as youth empowerment and engagement. For the disaster risk reduction ambassador, it is you will be focusing specifically on disaster management and making sure that you can help your country prepare for a resilient future. You ensure young people's voices are heard when it comes to the mitigation, and as well as working along with the National Youth Guard. We have, like Shantez would have mentioned, young people have a big role to play when it comes to the mitigation of our future. We are the people who are likely to be here in the next 50, 60 years. And so we have to make sure that we have a Bahamas to live in.
Yeah.
To be an ambassador for this specific program, I think, is a huge feat. And I think the people who are selected will have they'll have an omen's task, but I think it'll be appreciate at the end of the day to know that they did their part for disaster management in the Bahamas.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So
absolutely. And there'll be benefits too.
Yes.
The winners will get, I mean,
well, that helps.
I think there's a great call and responsibility that Jordan spoke to, but I think that we should also say that there'll be opportunities for networking. There'll be public appearances. Mm-hmm. They will each get a laptop. They will each get a paid internship with the Disaster Risk Management Authority in the summer. So getting that
training.
There will be training. We have community emergency response training. We will not be doing that. That's a very intense thing for a 10th grader to do, but we will be doing a version of that. Tailored for them. So they will get, you know, concrete certifications out of this, an internship, so that's career experience and payment. I want to say it is a paid internship.
Right.
And
for 8 weeks.
And like I said.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah.
And like I said, that computer. So.
Okay. Sounds good. All right. We're going to break for news. Do you have a senior ambassador competition by any chance? No, guess not. Let's go to the break. When we come back, we want to talk a little bit more about climate change because we started the show. The response is strange what people think in this country about climate change and about our response internationally on climate change. We want to get your reaction to that. This is Morning Blend. We're going to take this into business in just a bit. Stay with us.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day.
Good morning and welcome to Morning Blend Business on this Wednesday, November 13th, 2024. Welcome back to our Morning Blend listeners. Once again, I'm Dwight Strawn along with Chester Robards, and we are continuing our conversation about the DRM Youth Ambassador Program. I think it's the DR...
The Disaster Risk Reduction.
Okay, yeah. DRR. Youth Ambassador Program, part of the DRMA. And we're talking with Shantez Dillett-Wilson and Jordan Clark. All right, so you gave us information. We'll go back over that before we let you go. But let's talk about it. Climate change, there's still people who are saying, we got a text this morning about how, you know, first was global warming, now it's climate change, and clearly this is fake. And also people reacting. I thought it was a wonderful speech the Prime Minister gave in Azerbaijan, but plenty of people were like, this is just talk because there's no evidence of us being serious about this here in the Bahamas. And we know the concerns. We are cutting down trees. We're filling in mangroves. We barely have any hills left in New Providence. Are we just talking or are we serious about saving and protecting our environment and mitigating these issues?
DRM Authority. Mm-hmm. What we will say is that, you know, from where we sit, the Prime Minister has made a great commitment. We actually meet with him monthly to discuss disaster preparedness, like the full scope of our mandate every single month with Prime Minister. So he's made a serious commitment in that way. And honestly, the formation of the DRM Authority is in its own way a huge commitment. It is a shift from... I think that it may be a little bit technical and in the weeds. You'd have to work in the industry to understand the magnitude of the shift. I think that most people will be able to see it in the impacts of it. But the magnitude is big. We're only the second country in the Caribbean to really make the shift into this comprehensive disaster management model that we've been using. And our legislation is... a model for the rest of the Caribbean. I was recently down in St. Vincent for the Caribbean Disaster Ministers Council, and it was surprising to me and also gratifying, I suppose, how many of them came up to us and said they're considering making a shift towards what the Bahamas is doing now, modeling after us. Could they see our legislation? Could they get a meeting with us to talk about how they can advocate for their own ministers and their own cabinets to make changes that we've made? Mm. So there has been a real commitment by the government of the Bahamas generally to shift the way they gate disasters.
Yeah. So how do we get the public on the same page, on board, recognizing that we are making these moves and we're not just talking, we are practicing what we're preaching?
I guess that's on us comms people. yeah, you know, you'll see a lot more of us in the coming. You know, we've been very preoccupied with hurricane season recently. You know, we were formed, you know, in a short while ago and jumped right into hurricane season stuff. But in what we call blue sky time, you'll be hearing a lot more of, you know, us talking about us as a new organization, what we're doing, how we're different. So you'll see more of us too, Dwight.
Okay.
But I mean, also just from, I want to make another caveat. Disaster management is expensive. The Prime Minister is out there. Prime Minister is out there advocating and focusing on climate finance. And we, you know, couldn't be more part of that. Finance is one of the biggest things. Even in that meeting in St. Vincent, the biggest thing that they discussed was finance. How are we funding this? And mitigation, the funding that it requires to switch to new ways of doing things, you of not using resources the way that we've been using them, and doing things differently that are better for the environment, that costs a lot of money.
Yeah.
And so, you know, that there's a reason that the whole entire Caribbean and all small island developing states have been really pushing for this climate finance aspect of it. Mm-hmm. It's very costly for small countries to make some of these big changes, especially against how much our emissions actually contribute to what is happening.
Right.
No, so. That was going to be my question. Just, you know, we have a nice model that people are saying, yeah, this, you did a great job putting it together. But how do we bring the words out of the legislation and into practicality for the country without the money? You're just starting out. We haven't gotten that mm-hmm. big finance that we want. So what are the small things that DRMA is able to do now and other people are able to do now to help against?
Thank you for that question. DRM Authority, by the way. So some of the things that we are already doing, one of the biggest changes in how we handled Milton and Oscar was we are giving a lot more power to the family islands. We are devolving the way that we allocate resources. You would have seen the administrators on TV, in radio, heard from them a lot more than you may have in the past because we
oh,
have...
Oh, okay, that was intentional.
That was intentional.
Oh, okay.
That
I
was,
thought it was a fluke.
No. It was
interesting.
It was intentional. We have we are about empowering those communities to ensure that they have the resources to act locally
mm-hmm.
because one of the things that we find is that, you know, if they are cut off, it's a part of how we deal with our archipelagical... being an archipelago is, you know, if they are cut off either communication-wise or transport-wise, you know, they can't be reliant on Nassau. Now, we are always here to support. And we, you know, we have entirely, not entirely overhauled, but we are in the process of, you know, really upgrading our communications so that we have so many redundancies that that's a minor problem.
Mm-hmm.
But, but we want to ensure that they are able to act locally and... especially since they know those communities best.
Yeah.
You know, we do a lot of work to ensure that we're in contact with them, their communities need to. But at the end of the day, they know their communities best. So it's best that we empower them to be able to act locally. And we saw in Grand Bahama that actually worked really well. A lot of the community, especially over in East End, we're talking about how their family island administrator really supported them well.
Excellent.
So, you know, we got good feedback on that. And we are incorporating what feedback, you know, we did get into how we do that differently next time.
Because I always felt that so much time is lost waiting for Nassau to come and do the assessment.
Especially for Southern Bahamas.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. All right, so that's great.
And ways that people could be more involved, I would say making sure that you are doing your hurricane preparation in what we call blue sky time. Well, May to prepare for hurricanes. Make sure that you are doing everything that you need outside of that time. And some of the longer lead things that you can be doing is, you know, checking in to make sure that you have home insurance. If you are a homeowner, we know that that's a costly thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, seeing what options are available to you. If that's not an option, at the very least, should be checking and inspecting your home to make sure that you are fixing things over time that may be a threat in hurricane season beforehand, because we definitely know that repairs can be costly. So if you're, you know, starting earlier, you know, sharing that burden out over a longer period of time, you know, you'll have a more secure structure that you're waiting out storms in.
Yeah.
Another big thing that's important for Bahamians to know and to remember is to, during blue sky times, prepare your family emergency plan, knowing who's going to go and batten up Grammy House because she lived by herself, knowing who's going to pick her up and if the storm gets too strong for her to be there by herself, where y'all going to meet up if you get separated in the middle of a storm, like, these are the things that should be happening during blue sky time. So when, God forbid, something hits, everybody already knows what's going to happen.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Those are very important things.
Is the DRM Authority mitigation in any large sense?
That is more on the climate change and environmental advisory unit within the office of the OPM.
Mm-hmm.
So mitigation for us is more very specifically, how are we putting in term, long-term institutional solutions for disaster risk.
Yeah.
Now I was going to ask, and maybe this is a suggestion for the future, why not have two sets of ambassadors, youth ambassadors, Family Islands and then like Nassau, Grand Bahama. Because I think from what you kind of mentioned is their situations are kind of much different, you know, what they grow up in and what mm-hmm. they see around them than New Providence and like Grand Bahama.
And their disaster impact is different. It's different. That's an excellent suggestion. Yeah. Thank you.
So you want four ambassadors?
Yes.
That's what I'm saying.
Yes.
Okay.
You need four. All the ambassadors.
Every four
island.
Computers.
Every island has one.
Four jobs.
I'm just participating in Guardian Radio and Chick Charney to come on
that's
as sponsors
right.
next year for those two Family Island
and
ambassadors.
Let's do this.
As you said as well.
Let's do this.
Let's see if we can take this call, and we've got some interesting text messages as well. Good morning, caller. You're on the air. Are you there? No. Okay. Call us back. This texture says here, every night I go home very late. I'm in IT, I think they're saying. I see all these bright lights shining at some of the businesses, especially the high-rise business, I guess, in them. I try recently to tell a resident in Georgetown, Exuma, about leaving her car running while shopping, and boy, did I get a mouthful. Maybe we should start at home to do our part. Every little bit counts. Well, absolutely.
I mean, absolutely. I'm not going to advocate against everybody doing their part. Yeah. I will say that, you know, institutional changes will probably do a bigger part, but I think that everybody should take responsibility.
Definitely. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
100%.
What kind of pocketbook you got if you're leaving your car running while you're
right?
Gas ain't nothing but money ain't nothing but a thing when you get burning gas.
Sometimes if you turn it off, it won't start again. But anyway, good morning, caller. You're on the air.
What kind of car it was.
Hi, you're on the air. Hi, good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Morning, guys. How you doing?
Doing well.
Good. I think, Dwight, you asked an important question about the Prime Minister advocating a way for financing, you know. I just say, feel that we are not actively doing our part. And when you go away and you can appeal for funding, and, you know, you have to demonstrate a degree that your part in all of this is that you're doing stuff at home as a proactive partner, you know, in the fight against this climate change, man, you know. It's, for me, in the tourism industry, to see expanding crews, that's a big footprint. You know, it doesn't appear that you know, you're serious about it because it's expanding with these big resorts, all these marinas, all of this stuff creates damaging effects to the environment and you know, into our resources. Not encouraging a lot of education because obviously this is a good initiative here. But then on the flip side, we doing all of these stuff as a result of not encouraging more small boutique hotels, eco lodges. In these family islands, you know. So I think that, you know, we are not doing it. It to me, from the outside looking in, it appears that it's just talk. We're not demonstrating our commitment to this process at all. And then when you go ask for money, you know, if I could see it, they're seeing it also.
Okay, all right, let's get them to respond. Thanks a lot, appreciate it. Shantez, Jordan, you want to respond to that? I mean, you said it earlier. It's happening, perhaps, and you need to get the word out more.
So, you know, he's talking about, once again, environmental mitigation and getting into a space where the DRM authority does not, you know, directly impact, you know, obviously that impacts what we do. Mm-hmm. I will say that, you know, our experience was a commitment to this at all. Like I said, we are seen as a leader in this space in the Caribbean. So, you know, but we will continue. We take your feedback on board, caller. We will definitely be ensuring that we amplify this program because education is incredibly important. And, you know, you talked a lot about the intersectionality between, you know, environmental impacts, people's economic positions, and ownership of the economy. We, while not from the angle that you discussed, because once again, a little bit out of our purview, we are entirely aware of that as well and understand how, you know, having stakeholder and community engagement in building our processes throughout all of the communities of the Bahamas is important to how we're building the way that we respond, because as we have seen, it's not just lives that are lost, it's livelihoods that are lost when disaster strikes, and we are about preventing that. That is in our mandate. Yeah. So.
Speaking of ensuring things, with an I. Does the DRM authority have conversations about this insurance problem that the country is facing with home insurance and property insurance?
Yes, it does. And it's actually a Caribbean-wide. Now, you know, there is the CRIF, mm-hmm. which is, you know, currently still a lot of details being hammered out. But it's an ongoing conversation that we are actively engaged in. But, yeah. you know, I can't. I don't have any progress to update to you at the moment, unfortunately.
All right, one final call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Strawn, Chester, and the Apollo.
Hi.
Good morning.
You know, Dwight, one wouldn't deny that reducing carbon emissions would be great, right? But coming on the radio with harmonious, mellifluous voices and being ignorant about what really is the science behind the climate change agenda, right? And one question for the guests is, did UB have any close environmental studies that really show what our most proliferated trees offset? Like, you know, you could do a controlled environment. Like, there was a study on the beechnut tree from Germany that 80 years old, it offsets a certain amount of kilograms, I think 12.5 kilograms or whatever per year. So what I'm saying is, in other words, then you would have to look at, I can't remember how much gigatons carbon is emitted every year, right, from collectively. And then we look at how the world is set up panoramically from space, and we look at the amount of trees that we have. And then we will determine how much we can offset. So the PM is kind of correct with our grass, seagrass. But the thing is, there are species that photosynthesize that I'm not hearing about that they're not even, that they're just discovering. They just discovered some polymetallic rocks that actually absorbs carbon, all right? And so I say that to say this, is that anything that is made out of matter will deteriorate. So we know that, let's look at home. We see the emissions by the buses moving up and down, et cetera, et cetera. When they go to get licensed, the government could say, well, hey, this particular vehicle is emitting too much carbon monoxide, which turns to carbon dioxide 72 hours after it rises into the upper atmosphere. So when you look at the science, if you really look at the science, basically, you can't save the planet. We can. You're saying save the planet, but then the question becomes with a thinking mind. Have you done any studies to show if carbon dioxide?
This is we're getting straying a little bit from what they're here to talk about. But
I can respond not directly to what he's mm-hmm. saying because that's obviously outside of our purview. Mm-hmm. Though I'm glad that he's thinking about it. What I will say is that he makes an important point about data-driven decision making, which is one of the major mandates of our organization as well. We are putting together a disaster and hazards. And risk database that will compile data about past hazards and risks that we've experienced in the Bahamas, combining that with GIS data from our GIS department, et cetera, so that we can have better predictions on how different places will be affected when we have a hazard threatening our shores, and we can also have better data to respond. Also, he talked about UB. UB is, you know, intimately involved with a lot of what we are doing. They have a relationship that includes, you know, interaction with University of Hawaii and the Pacific Disaster Center. We are really, really, you know, we can't speak to beechnut trees, but we can speak to, you know, some of the things that we are collecting with regards to surges, with regards to mapping of those and what we're working in with these different entities yeah. to ensure that we're having data so that we are doing what we need to do as yeah. far as making those decisions in an evidence-based
Absolutely.
Way.
And we yeah. can't deny there are things that we're doing that are making things worse unnecessarily. And if you don't need to be doing those things, there are alternative things that you can do. Why not do them? Right? 52? No? All right. Remind people about the Youth Ambassador Program one more time. The deadline is coming up. We need to get everybody to apply, everybody in the 10th grade.
Absolutely. Everybody in the 10th grade apply. So yes, we're calling all 10th graders to join the Disaster Risk Reduction Youth Ambassador Video Speech Competition. So please submit 3 to 5 minute video speech on the theme Empowering the Next Generation for a Resilient Future. What does that mean to you? What do you need? What does it mean to be empowered to be the next voice and the next generation for disaster risk reduction, disaster management in our country. You can submit that to drm.gov.bs/speech-comp to connect@drm.gov.bs. drbs. Or if it's easier, follow us on any of our social platforms. We are at @DRM_authority. You can type that into Facebook, X, and Instagram. We are on all three. So follow us overall, and you can submit via our DM as well.
All right. So the deadline's the 30th. When will we know who the two ambassadors will be?
So we will be announcing in the second week of December.
Oh, okay. So pretty soon.
So pretty soon. So
what does
so
that pretty, adjudication process yeah. look like?
Yes. So we have a selection committee comprised of representatives from DRM, industry experts, Ministry of Youth, Ministry of Education, and some educators. So altogether, we have a rubric. We'll be judging you, obviously, on the content, the creativity, and delivery. So across those three metrics. Yeah. So make sure to ensure that you are well-researched. Feel free to get creative. And, of course, practice your speech delivery. Though we will also, in the ambassador program, be putting them through some speech training and public speaking training. So,
excellent. Are you worried about any of this coming from AI at all? I'm just asking you. You got to ask these things.
They're going to AI their images. It's a video competition.
No robots. Just asking. No robots.
They'll definitely get points for creativity if they know how to do that.
And hopefully we'll get to meet the two of them on the show.
Yes. Happy to have them.
Excellent. All right. It was a great conversation this morning. Chantez Dillette-Wilson and Jordan Clark, thank you for being here with us this morning.
Our
really
pleasure.
Appreciate it.
Thanks so much.
Yeah. All right. Let's take a break and be back with more Morning Blend business in just a bit.
This November, the Nassau Guardian is celebrating 180 years. And we want to thank you, our loyal readers, for helping to make this one of the oldest newspapers in the region. We want you to be a part of our Vision Challenge giveaway promotion beginning October 28th through November 22nd. All you need to do is find the hidden Nassau Guardian 180 years logo printed every day in the Nassau Guardian newspaper, and you could win prize money. Just purchase your daily Nassau Guardian newspaper every day beginning Monday, October 28th. Find the 180th Nassau Guardian logo, cut out the page, mark the spot, write your name and phone number on that clipping, drop off your entries at our offices on Carter Street in Oaksfield, and every Friday, November 1st, November 8th, November 15th, and November 22nd, one drawing will take place. It's that simple.
This holiday season, give the gift that lasts a lifetime. Financial freedom with CFAL. Whether you're looking to take the stress out of holiday giving or plan for the future, CFAL has you covered. With our suite of savings products, you can start with a minimal upfront investment and low monthly contributions. Get a jump start with 2025 financial goals with CFAL Savings Express with the CFAL Education Plan. You can also secure your own future with the CFAL Blue Marlin Retirement Plan. This holiday season, make your gift count with CFAL, where small savings lead to brighter futures. Visit CFAL.com today to start building wealth so you can live well. Happy holidays from all of us at CFAL.
Are you a Bahamian with property on one of our 16 island destinations? Well, the Tourism Development Corporation, in partnership with the Bahamas Development Bank, is officially launching our Home Sweet Home Incentive. Join the vacation market by transforming your properties into vacation rentals. Earn up to $10,000 or more in funding and start building today. Register at tdcbahamas.com. from October 7th to November 18th. What are you waiting on? Build your vacation home today.
Have you already tried our President Butter? Ooh la la. Indulge a little with President, because now more than ever, we need to savor the taste, textures, and feelings to truly enjoy the little things that mean the most. President Butter, something to savor.
All those loans I had were so overwhelming. Fidelity's debt consolidation loan combined all my loan payments into one easy payment with a built-in savings plan that pays me unbeatable interest. It's time to make that move. 7764.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
This holiday season, give the gift that lasts a lifetime.
Financial freedom with CFAL. Whether you're looking to take the stress out of holiday giving or plan for the future, CFAL has you covered. With our suite of savings products, you can start with a minimal upfront investment and low monthly contributions. Get a jump start with 2025 financial goals with CFAL Savings Express, or give the little ones a head start with the CFAL Education Plan. You can also secure your own future with the CFAL Blue Marlin Retirement Plan. This holiday season, make your gift count with CFAL, where small savings lead to brighter futures. Visit CFAL.com today to start building wealth so you can live well. Happy holidays from all of us at CFAL.
It is time for your morning business report, brought to you by CFAL. Ministry of Tourism, Investments, and Aviation Executive Director of Global Communications, Paul Strawn, says the ministry is eyeing a direct connection from the UK to Grand Bahama in order to open the island up to European visitor traffic. The country currently has direct flights to the UK through Nassau with both British Airways and Virgin Atlantic, while British Airways plans to continue servicing the Bahamas through Nassau. Virgin Atlantic has planned to part ways with the country next year. Following a network review, Virgin announced that it will suspend operations to the Bahamas and the Turks and Caicos in 2025, favoring increased frequency to other Caribbean destinations and South Africa. Virgin's final flight to Turks and Caicos will depart on February 21st of next year, while the final flight to the Bahamas will leave on February 23rd. Strong says a Grand Bahama route from the UK would be an attractive proposition for Grand Bahama and the country. Read more on this in today's Guardian Business segment. The developer of the proposed $30 million King's Court luxury hotel on West Bay Street is looking to begin construction in quarter one next year, but obtaining a certificate of environmental clearance is holding them back. Principal of Gibson Development Limited, Eric Gibson Jr., telling Guardian Business that he wanted to start construction by the end of November, but was made to understand that obtaining the CEC can take anywhere from a few months to a few years. The Department of Environmental Planning and Protection is a document outlining the CEC process, promises that after a review of the project's environmental documents, that the developer would be informed of the status within 60 days. And five apprentices are working on site at Carnival Celebration Key in Grand Bahama, with island site development, thanks to a paid apprenticeship program. The program is part of a partnership with the BTVI, Bahamas Technical and Vocational Institute. According to a statement from BTVI, the five apprentices were shortlisted from a group of 10 highly motivated students. And the Bahamas Development Bank appointing a new chairman, Delfino Gilbert Casar, is the chair of the board, an accomplished private banker, said to bring extensive expertise in private banking, digital assets, and technology-driven finance to his new role. Overseas, inflation in the United States ticking up in October, driven by costlier rents, used cars, and airfares, a sign that price increases might be leveling off after having slowed in September to their lowest pace since 2021. Consumer prices rose 2.6% from a year earlier, according to the Labor Department today, up from 2.4% in September. It was the first rise in annual inflation in 7 months. From September to October, prices edged up 0.2%, the same as the previous month. Excluding volatile food and energy costs, core prices rose 3.3% year, the same as in September. From September to October, core prices rose 0.3% for a third straight month. Over the long run, core inflation beat Federal Reserve targets of 2%. Most of the monthly increase in consumer prices reflected an increase in rents and housing costs, a trend that Fed officials expect to fade in the coming months. As a result, though, Wednesday's figures could climb in December, as officials have previously indicated they likely would. And a hacking group believed to be in an attack meant to install malware on users' computers. That's according to findings released today by a private cybersecurity group. The hack of the Tibet Post and Gyudmed Tantric University and their websites appears geared toward obtaining access to the computers of people visiting to obtain information on them and their activities. That's according to the analysis of Insect Group, the threat research division of the Massachusetts provides the website so that visitors are prompted to download a malicious executable file disguised as a security certificate. Once open, the file loads Cobalt Strike Beacon malware on the user's computer that can be used for purposes including deploying additional malware. Capping trading on the BSIX from 19,350 shares, closing up 32 cents, closing up 12, moving 1,000, down 1 cent to 11.30. Consolidated Water down, rated down 8 cents, closing at 8.85. The BSIX All Share Index closing at 2,897 points. And that is your morning business report brought to you by CFAL. And we're back with Morning Blend Business on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strawn along with Chester Robart. I want to get to in the news and business news. So the big headline in the NASA Guardian today, cost of living rise shocking, but major grocer says holiday prices will be stable. Our University of the Bahamas study. Super Value owner Rupert Roberts said yesterday his buyers have been mandated to carefully examine international markets in a bid to keep current prices at the very least stable. Super Value lead buyers told the NASA Guardian yesterday that headed into the holiday season and the new year, prices are expected to remain stable, but customers are being urged to give up their love affair with popular brands, which have consistently risen in costs every quarter due to manufacturers passing on increases. Yikes. Speaking after he was contacted, Robert said, quote, years ago and $10,000 today to feed a family of four. That shocked people misinterpreting the survey, the study, and it's really talking about the studies with UB for the livable was for low income basic families, right? This most recent study was about middle class, and if you want to be in what Bahamians consider to be the middle class, what it would take to maintain that lifestyle. So it's different. Now, according to these studies, the livable wage is up now to $6,000 a month, or that's what low-income families would need to make in order to make it.
Right.
Right? So it's a lot of different terms. A lot of things are not saying that costs would jump from that to this. It's a totally different study, and hopefully there'll be more information about this shortly so people can get on the same page. But anyway, but Robert said, quote, this covers food, and of course we know it's gas and it's rent and it's other costs of living, but we're very conscious of it and we're doing all we can. Robert's referencing the UB study, which found that a middle-class family of four in New Providence needs about $10,200 to have a decent life or $10,000 a month if living in Grand Bahama, if you want to be considered middle class, right? Consumers continue to complain about the high prices, though. Roberts has had a consistent buyers, quote, go out, look for deals, and let's see if we can feed the people and use bargains, values, and specials so we can buy at a lower cost and offer to the public at a lower cost. He pointed out that there are multiple factors that lead to higher costs, and those factors are out of Super Value's control. He said, quote, we get blamed, of course, because they purchase it from us. We get blamed for whatever we import, higher freight costs, higher product costs, and there's a lot of merchandise that still has duty. He pointed to an example of a cost increase beyond Super Value's control. He said, quote, about 3 months ago, we were selling eggs for $2.99. Today, I think our price is about $5.90. Wow. Bird flu hit again. I was hoping that the $2.99 would carry us through baking season. And of course, this is a big issue in the U.S. apparently. Egg costs impacting people as they were heading to the polls. So Robert says the government's price control inspectors have been diligent in keeping and checking prices and price controlled items, helping them to police the stores, he says, and he's grateful for it. asked to fall under the best price control, they fall under competition. We are charged with putting food on the Bahamian table at the best possible price, and we want to have the best prices on the non-price control. He noted that the United States is no longer the grocery chain's major supplier. We're buying a lot of products out of Brazil now. The supermarkets in the States are mainly U.S. products and forbidden import from all over the world, and we do Trump administration that companies are going to try harder to bring down the cost to take a hard look at and see what's contributing to the high cost and do not let it go any higher every day. Well, Super Value's last holiday season, Sans says food prices have induced inflation. Sans offering advice to shoppers, saying, quote, my best, the national brands are what's killing the customers' pockets. We're trying out best to bring, they don't want it. They only want national brands, and that's what's going up. And then they stand, but nobody seems to want them. Super Value's perishable buyer, Clifton Fernander, said the aim remains to find, quote, hams and turkeys. The prices are going to be about the same as last year. We were able to buy right. Produce items will be about the same. We don't anticipate any significant increases in produce. All right, so there's more of that in the paper today, so read more about it. But let's get your reaction to it. Buying off brands, the off market, the non-national brands, the ones you've never heard of. How comfortable are you with it?
That are coming from other countries seem off. Don't they?
I know what you mean.
Yeah.
Sometimes, especially when it's not in the language you know.
Exactly. Yeah.
So. Can't tell if it's the same.
And so you wonder about the ingredients. You know, I think those are some of the concerns.
Well, I have to admit, in the last few months, I've been trying some things that weren't exactly okay. But what I've seen is sometimes you try these things, and then when you go back, it's not there.
It's not there.
It's not there. Like, wait, what happened to that one?
That's a big problem.
Like, what's this? So they were like trying it out on us, and then you did like it, and now you can't. And it's months before it comes back, which is very frustrating. Not just at Super Value, and it's been happening for a while now. So 6232-325-4259. Call us toll free 242-300-5720. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us.
I need to find that off brand olive oil because olive oil.
Oh my gosh! Gee. That's what I've been doing, right? Like, what is this
Where
thing?
Is the
like, off-brand? Is this really from a place that produces olives? Yeah. Like, okay, I'm the take.
And there were concerns about fake olive oil on the market.
I saw that. Yeah. I did try one. It wasn't bad. The price was way better than the ones that I normally bought.
Yeah.
Gosh. Gonna start. Can we grow olive trees here?
I wonder.
It's time to start pressing them. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning, Greg. Good morning to the other gentleman.
Morning.
Chester,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, what I have been noticing recently shopping at some of the major food stores because of the high cost of living, I don't think they are shuffling a lot of those produce, particularly in the produce section. You have a lot of spoiled stuff in those areas. And I believe you now run a risk of buying items that only have a certain timeline on those shelves. So I think we are in a serious predicament because we are not just paying more the quality in the produce departments. A lot of them are just being sitting there for far too long. And Bahamians go in there and they sift for the best ones. But even the best ones are sometimes they're no good. We find a lot of spoiled stuff among those produce, like cassava, potatoes, and a lot of outdated lettuce and tomato. You can tell they're a little bit old and should no longer be there. And I think the stores are still trying to sell them because they paid so much to bring them in. They got to make some kind of profit, but they're doing it at the expense of our health. Thank you.
Oh, boy. Okay. Well, you know, you got to show the people working. Hey,
no, the strawberries is be struggling.
It's not good. So they'll take it off the shelf. If I see something I'll put it right on the ground. I'm sorry. Nobody, don't even consider selling this.
You're carrying yellow caution tape with you in
right.
the store.
Like, Nope. This should be on sale. On the ground. Anyway, what's not being talked about is the lack of production in the Bahamas. If we don't make something, then we'll have to import it. I think it is being talked about. Maybe it not is, as... It is. Mean, what's being done about it, right? And who?
No one's had the wherewithal to take it on. Over the, I don't know. I don't know why. I mean, I guess we were focused on tourism, but it's amazing to me to go to Jamaica and Trinidad. Those really the only factories where they're making food.
Well, if you don't think you could get Bahamian to be a gardener and to be a mason, I don't know who you think is going to be in the factories. But anyway, that's another show, or is it? Is it another show? Because it's the same thing we've been talking about all morning.
Yeah.
But yeah. All right. So, really quickly, in the business section of the National Guardian today, mega resorts need to encourage guests to leave properties. Ayori Kemp writing about this. Eric Gibson, owner of the popular Bahama Grill restaurant, is raising alarm over what he called a broken system where hotels are not incentivizing guests to leave the properties. Hotels are not incentivizing the guests to leave the properties. Gibson, whose restaurant is on West Bay Street, said 80% of his customers are locals and 20% are tourists. Is there an issue? Is there a problem? Anyway, he said, quote, if you objectively look around at all the restaurants that are in Nassau and think about the hundreds of tourists we have every day in Nassau on any given day, and anyone can quickly surmise that the percentage of persons that visit restaurants, the restaurant, independent restaurants, is very limited. That's my view, because we have what I would call a broken system. Individual restaurants itself technically should be so busy that they don't know what to do because of our tourism. We have millions of dollars pass into the Bahamas all the time. He said restaurants on family islands appear to have a 50-50 split between visitors and locals, but on New Providence, it's not the case. He said, quote, my restaurant is geared directly towards the tourists. Serving Bahamian cuisine, and the reason why I can't get my share and the reason why other restaurants can't get their share is because everybody wants to keep their guests at their establishment. Two big players, Bahama and Atlantis, bring their guests in. They want them to stay on their property. They do nothing to encourage the guests to explore outside the property. There needs to be greater incentivization for tourists to explore the island of Nassau and not be so stuck inside of the large mega and all-inclusive resorts, which can do more to support the local economy. Gibson said Fish Fry is able to survive because the individual vendors pay taxi drivers to drive tourists into the venue. Okay, I think you're answering your questions here. That's how it works, right? I don't think it's only here that we have these issues. But I think I'm going to stop here because we're running out of time. But also because I think if people heard that, you won't believe what they do at that place. They are throwing the fish up in the air and cooking it in midair or whatever. flame-throwing it, cooking it with a drone. People will come. If they hear that it's such an amazing experience, people will come.
Yeah.
And if you market yourself properly, people will come.
Yeah.
I don't know if many are doing that in the restaurant business.
And as a future hotelier, I think you'll...
Who?
Gibson.
Oh, I thought you were saying you were speaking.
Not me. Okay, not me. I think you'll find that he wants people in his hotel to eat at his restaurant multiple times during their stay.
Right. Will he incentivize them to go out?
Yeah.
But let's get your reaction to it. Is that how it should work? Or this is the same thing we're saying, right? The same thing with the cruise ships. They're not leaving the ships or the port area because they don't feel there's anything out there.
Right.
And often they're not wrong. Or when there is something, you haven't done a better job of getting the word out.
How are you grabbing them? How are you grabbing them during their time?
Yeah. Let's even get your reaction to this really quickly. We're running out of time. But which one is it? Let's hear from this caller. Good morning. You're on the air.
Hey, Dwight. How you doing?
Doing well.
We may be telling, and my brother snuck into the Bahamas on a cruise ship, we may be telling the tourists it's not safe. We may be telling them not to travel with too much credit cards or cash when they leave the certain areas. I won't call names. We may be putting up what appears to be the tallest fence I've ever seen there around the boats, which gives the feeling of maybe it's not safe on the outside of the fence. You know, my mother came to the Bahamas in 1958 on a cruise ship. She went all over this island. Cat and the Fiddle, remember that? And Bahamians actually walked her back to the cruise ship, my father, and said, make sure you get on the boat safe, ma'am. Charmed so much, she married a Bahamian. But now, we have a little piece of paradise here on one tip of Paradise Island, and you can come right from the lovely boat to swim with the pigs right over here. And you don't have to go where it's not safe. See, safety and electricity will kill tourism for the organics. It's time to fix the Bahamas. Okay? Stafford Sands used to make you close your ship down at night. No food, no casino, nothing. And you would come off and eat, and you'll come and party with us. Property, and you're being abused as if you're over the hill in a ghetto somewhere.
Yeah. We do need the safety, so we need the people to stop fighting and the shooting and the stabbing and the urinating all over the place. We need everybody to do what they're supposed to do.
Yeah.
Everybody. But hey, we gotta go, Chester Robards. We need to have you back on the show to talk about how you were climbing up on buildings and stuff and doing stuff.
I didn't climb on a building.
How did you even get up there? I haven't been up there since 1980 something.
Lots of stairs. I huffed.
You were able to get in there.
To the top. Yes.
The stairs worked.
Yes, of course.
They didn't break under you.
Wow.
I mean, seriously, when was the last time somebody went up there?
Lots of people up there right now.
Oh, yeah?
Working to fix the place.
So we're going to have you back to talk about it. You're talking about him in the water tower, playing Spider-Man all over the water tower. But so we're going to be able to go up on the water tower soon.
Eventually.
Again.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's a beautiful sight, isn't it?
Oh, it's amazing. It makes you forget. All the problems that you stand on.
I will never forget it.
Yeah.
Seeing this beautiful island from up there.
Yeah.
Chester, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
I'll see you again soon. I'll be back tomorrow morning with more Morning Blend and Morning Blend Business here on Guardian Radio 96.9 Dwight Strawn. Have a great day, everybody. Stay tuned for On the Clock with Aaron Green next.
Celebrate the ease of opening a new account online with Scotiabank. Follow these three steps to access a world of possibilities. Step 1, visit bs.scotiabank.com. Step 2, select an account type to best suit your needs. Step 3, complete the form and upload your documents. Open your new Scotiabank account online today.
Make your new more with the appliances, furniture, and repair. Whatever you want, we got it all. Promise Furniture, the one that's all. We give it you, we make it worthwhile.
We make
even
it worthwhile.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.